Hello everybody and welcome to part 2 of my Genshin Impact woodcutting slash maybe fishing Q&A video series. So the first episode went up to over 2 hours long and can be found prior to this in the description of the video as well as in the playlist if you are watching through that. So if your questions are not answered in this episode, then chances are they were probably answered in that episode. But we are returning to continue the questions. This is on the same session day. My voice is starting to go out. That's totally okay. That's totally okay, man. So I'm looking forward to answering more questions. It's been a lot of fun so far. So let me go ahead and look at my list here. We've got everyone that's kind of still... Oh my god, there's like a lot. This is going to be a three-part video. It's totally going to be three parts. Oh my god. Because I'm looking to see exactly what I have left, and I have a shitload of people left still, and most everyone else that's left has like fucking 5-10 questions each. So we're probably going to be splitting this into three, but I don't know. We'll just have to wait and see. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to bounce back and forth. Oh, you guys have no idea what I'm talking about. I'm just looking at my list of names and the questions, and then I'll kind of bounce back and forth. So we're going to start this video right off with answering questions from Ulrich Ruby, who has posted 4 days ago and has posted 5 questions for me. So question number 1, will your Genshin teams always be based purely on your interest in the characters, or will you also try some meta team compositions in the future? Now, I've been very out with my opinion on meta in games. I don't like the flavor of the month anything really, so chances are I probably will not try. I won't build a meta team and then that's my team, but I might do it someday just to humor people and see, you know, like what people are always talking about, and then build the team however, whatever the flavor of the month team is, and then I'll try that. My parties, as explained earlier in the previous episode, will most likely always be based off of what I'm interested in playing, who I'm interested in playing, or a party I want to build because there's characters I haven't played with yet or whatever. And of course, I can always try to hone various characters in together in the future, but I don't really want to just go with, hey, these 4 characters can currently do the highest amount of crit damage in the game, so you have to play that and make sure you're using all this same gear. You know, it's just like Borderlands 2 Ultimate Vault Hunter mode. It's a total waste of fucking time because you can no longer play the way you want to. You have to play a specific way in order to even get anywhere. Thankfully, Genshin doesn't go that far with it. I can play whoever I want and get anywhere I want. So that's just where I stand on that. But like I said, I might try out a, as you say, meta team composition just for the sake of it someday, just to see. But right now, probably not. Question number 2 is, do you have any plans for, or, excuse me, plans for if, or when you will play more of the Spiral Abyss in Genshin? So, much like on the topic of what I was just talking about, the Spiral Abyss is not very interesting to me because in the early levels, you can fight through it. And obviously, if you have been watching the series recently, you'll know that I did actually do some Spiral Abyss levels in, I don't know, a few episodes back, specifically to do my, to get my weekly thing so that I could get a little bit further in the battle pass. The reason I do not like the concept of the Spiral Abyss is because I know where it's going to go. I'm in the easy levels now, but I know where this type of thing will go later. It gets to a point. Now, I haven't actually done this in Genshin, so I can't say for sure, but I can almost guarantee that it will require you to have a very specific build, very specific playstyle in order to complete the thing. I can almost guarantee that that's how it's going to go, and I'm just not interested in that type of challenge. But that's just me. So I might touch it again in the future. I'll never say never, and of course someday I might want to try to at least complete the whole thing once, but right now it's not really interesting to me. Number 3. What type of Genshin character are you hoping we will get in the future? By type of character, I mean general things like a healer of a specific element or a weapon type paired with an element. So this is a fun question. So I would love to have... Let me think about this for a moment. Because I'm sure... I'm sure there's a lot of things I could come up with, a lot of ideas. But I think I would like to have, because they have tried to do something, at least for like every element, but I don't think there's a character of a weapon type, of a class type, of every single individual thing. So you don't have a healer of each weapon type for every class. I'm just trying to think about something I would like. I think I would like an electro bow user.
No touching.
That is best specifically DPS, not sub DPS, not support, not not any of those subclasses. It's pure DPS and can handle her own. Yes, I said her own because I want it to be a female character. I guess the closest we would have to that right now is Fischl, but I'm talking something a little bit more like Ganyu. Doesn't have to have the AoE attack, but something where your actual bow is doing a lot of the damage, not Oz with, you know, and elemental reactions from someone else. Specifically where the bow is doing the kick-ass. I think I would really like that, because I explained in the previous episode, I really like archery. Bow users are really fun to me in games, and I love bow users in Genshin, Ganyu's being my favorite. And I would like to have something like that, but electro. I would say Pyro, but we have characters like Yuimiya, where she actually uses her bow to kick serious ass, because even her skill is to flame up her bow and use that to fast attack. So I think getting an electro version, that would be really nice. But there's a lot of other things. I would like more polearm users of different types. I think it'd be interesting to have like a healer character be a polearm user. I don't think we have that in the game. Unless we do, I don't know. But either way, moving on with the next question from Ulrich, we have question number 4, which is, who is your favorite character in Genshin? Including, now this isn't like the other questions where it's like, you know, who's your favorite character? Just period. This is specifically including gameplay, design, lore, and anything else you can think of. Unfortunately, I can't say too much about lore, because I don't know a lot about these characters. I haven't really, like, you know, delved into their stories and dialogue you can listen to in game by raising their friendship. I haven't dug into that yet. But as far as talking design is concerned, I have pre-planned a video someday where I would like to look at all the characters in Genshin Impact up to whatever characters we have in the game as of that video's creation, where I do look at every character and break down their designs and all the aspects of the designs that I love or don't like. I've been wanting to make that type of video for a while, so I probably won't talk too much about that, but since you're talking gameplay, design, lore, and everything else, I'll talk about gameplay and design. Because Ganyu, I love for her gameplay, but her design might not be entirely, and her outfit might not be entirely up to snuff for me, but I love her horns. I love horny girls. I love animal girls, either with horns or animal ears, and unfortunately we don't have enough horned girls in the game. And Ganyu is one of like 2 or 3 horned girls, and that's it. And I think she's like, who else? I think Yanfei has a type of horn, but it's not the type I'm looking for. And Nilou does not have horns. That's just a headdress she wears that are supposed to resemble horns. But regardless, let me look here for Genshin characters. So I'm looking this up on the internet right now just so that I can... God, it's like horrible. The list that's being provided, I would have preferred to be in the game. Because there are certain character designs I really like, but then I've never played the character or haven't really messed around with them yet, so I can't say I like them. They're my favorite based off of gameplay. Like, I really like the design of the new character, Cadence, for example, or Candace. I always say Cadence. Stop it. Yeah, I love her design, but I don't play her yet, so I can't, you know, I can't base it off of gameplay. I'm just looking through the list here quickly to kind of see if I have to pick a favorite character based off of just gameplay so far. I really liked Xiangling, I liked Ayaka, and I really liked Ganyu. So I'd have to just pick Ganyu, which I know I keep picking for everything, but It's difficult to say my favorite character who is gameplay and design, because Ganyu is not the strongest as far as her design is concerned for me. I just really like how she plays, and I think she's adorable, and I like her horns. But there are other characters that have outfits or even body builds that I think are far more interesting than Ganyu's. I just don't play with them or haven't played with them yet. So I guess I'll have to just leave it at Ganyu for right now, which might be a bit of a boring answer, but I think that's the best I can do at the moment until I can formulate better responses later. Okay, so moving on. The next question, the final question, is question number 5. Which is your favorite Genshin event? Okay, there's an interesting question. My favorite event. Let's see. So thinking about some of the Genshin events I've played through, when I started playing the game, I think my first major event when I started playing Genshin was the first Lantern Rite event, if I remember correctly. And I think I remember the Lantern Rite events being, like, amongst the best, just because they're so big and gorgeous to look at, and they're Chinese, and China stuff is really cool. But I'm trying to think. I didn't really like that Inazuma event we had earlier this year, the festival one. That wasn't as big and grand as I was hoping it would be. I did really enjoy the Mondstadt event recently. I liked the Windbloom Festival from last year. I'm trying to think of, like, what my favorite event would be. It's like, what is my favorite event? I've never really even thought about that before. There are certainly activities from events that I could say were my favorites. I really wish there was more of the rhythm game stuff. But as far as picking a favorite event, I don't know if I could really answer that off the top of my head. I'd really have to sit and think about it and, like, look at every event we've played. Let me just think a little bit more here. Brain. Like, the Golden Archipelago was really cool because it was a new region to explore. It kind of teased you about Inazuma. So, I mean, that was kind of fun, but I don't know why I'm pop-catting here. Let me see. Genshin Impact event list. Just show me all the old events. No, not current and old event. They're not current and upcoming. Show me all the old ones. Dude! What the hell? It lied to me. Event history. Okay, here we go. What the hell? Oh, this is 2020. No wonder I don't understand any of this shit. 2021. Okay, here we are. This is when I started playing. Oh my god, I remember that! I remember the Hypostatic Symphony! Where you could fight the cubes, and I wasn't really, like, good at the game yet, so I don't think I ever did that. My first Lost Riches, January 18th! Oh, January 8th to January 18th. I think we did that, didn't we? Holy fuck! Guys, it's like a fucking blast to the past. What the hell? It's gonna make me cry. The Marvelous Merchandise! I remember that! What the hell, dude? Oh, okay. Oh, yeah, Lantern Rite. Right here, February 10th to February 28th. That was my first major event, I think, in Genshin Impact. I'd probably have to say one of the Liyue events. Probably one of the Lantern Rite events. Like, when they introduced the tower defense and stuff. I really liked that new aspect. So I think that's probably what I would have to choose. I'm going to say take that with a grain of salt, because I would really have to look at all of these and, like, compare them side by side and how I felt about them at the time, and then pick one of my favorites that way. But just going off of a basic list, that's probably the one I would choose. Oh, here's Midsummer Island Adventure. That was when we got Klee, June 9th to June 28th. So I'm just, like, looking through. Oh my god, guys, it's the Google Play gift card collaboration event that I just happened to see on, like, the last day while I was working at Walmart, because I saw it advertised on the thing. Dude, this is awesome. Yeah, okay, anyway, so that's that. I think I'll pick the Lantern Rite event. Either the first or, like, didn't they do a second one? Well, I'll pick either the first or the second one. One of the Lantern Rite, any of the Leeway Lantern Rite related things, I think, are what I would choose. Very, very nice looking. I have a lot of memories of just the orangey color palette, but. What the hell is this? Oh my god, it's weird. Okay, anyways, I was... What? Man, screw you if you play on PlayStation. You get that all exclusive content. Okay, anyways. moving on. That covers up all of Ulrich's questions, I hope. Now we are going to bounce to the next person, which is... XXZman9000XX posted 2 days ago with 8 total questions, starting with question number 1. I feel like you talked about this before, but what do you think of games like XCOM or strategy games with permadeath? So I'm assuming you're talking about like tactical strategy games where you have a character or a series of characters in like a turn-based strategy scenario where if your character dies, they're dead. And then you've got whoever's left in your squad or whatever, and then you either have to replace the dead guy or something, you know, whatever, right? I think that's kind of how XCOM works. I'm really interested in this type of game. I believe something that's sort of like this is Valkyria Chronicles, which is a game I would love to do an LP on someday. But I have never played XCOM properly, but I have seen footage of it, and it looks like a lot of fun. So I love strategy games, and you can technically make anything a strategy, but these tactical turn-based strategy games where you have to make decisions and how you move the characters around a field, and then obviously it's based a lot on stats, on whether you're going to hit a target from different distances, if they're behind cover or whatever, you know, etc. Just a whole bunch of different parameters that play into it. And if you lose your character, if one of them dies and they're dead, I do like the aspect of permadeath in certain games. Permadeath in the case of like a strategy game, a tactical strategy game, is really interesting because you can become attached to characters. And if there's permadeath in a strategy game, it implies that there is a lot more attention to building characters. Because if you look at like Command and Conquer, right, sure, you can earn veterancy ranks on your units, but they're basically fodder for the fight. So you build a big ball of units and throw it at the enemy, and then it's hard to manage keeping anything alive. Company of Heroes is a little better at that. You try to keep your heavy armored units alive, and you can, because you don't just send balls of enemies at your opponents at all times. So it becomes a little bit more tactical in your strategy. And in a game like XCOM, I guess taking care of a unit, making sure they're geared up with the right stuff, and spending a lot of time skilling them and everything else. When you lose a character that you've given a name, that you've spent hours building and getting ready, and then they die, it crushes you. Your soul is like, ugh! You know, and I like that aspect. As long as the game has some sort of way to keep you from reloading. Because if it lets you do that, then there's no point in having permadeath. If you can just reload and then get that character back and try again a different way. So, I'm assuming that he's on the topic of permadeath, because he goes on in question number 2 to ask, what do you think of roguelikes? And if you like them, do you have any favorites? So roguelikes are another type of game that I'm really interested in, but I have not played too many of them. So Gunfire Reborn, which I was talking about in last episode, is a roguelike game where, you know, if you die, you're done. Well, that's a roguelite game, which basically the difference between a roguelike and a roguelite, I believe roguelites still have permadeath, but you carry something over into each additional run. So you might carry over like a currency into your next run. That's a roguelite. Or maybe some of your skills carry over. So you're always beefing yourself up and you're more powerful for the next run. While a roguelike is more hardcore, I guess, because every run is always the rock bottom that you're starting at. Now, there's a couple different roguelikes that you can find. You've got the quick ones, where you start a run and then the run's over in 30 minutes because you died or you beat it. Like, Gunfire Reborn has an end to a run. You don't just keep going as long as possible until you die. It has an end. But that works for a roguelite because you get to carry over progress. I do like roguelikes more that have open-ended and endless gameplay, where you can technically keep going as long as you possibly can, but not to a point where the difficulty level becomes impossible, but where it's just based on your endurance, or something along those lines, your skill and endurance. And then when you die, you start over. And I also prefer roguelikes that have some heavy form of procedural generation, so that you have new and different ways to experience a run each time, rather than it being like, you know, the same game. Which I've never really seen a roguelike fail at doing that yet. I do have a couple, like I have, again, I think Risk of Rain I own, but I've never played it. And I have a couple others as well, and I guess you would consider games like Isaac's, whatever, the Isaac game series. I've got that too. I've played a little bit of that. It was actually really fun, but I suck at it. Damn, I suck at it. So I can't say I have any... If I had to pick a favorite, it would be Gunfire Reborn, because it's one of the few that I have played, and it's got really smooth gunplay. But I don't have enough to really sit down and pick apart and say, oh yeah, here's my 10 different favorite roguelikes, and this is probably the one I play the most. But I would like to play more of them someday. The number 3 on his question list is, on the woodcutting theme, I don't know if you have gotten the new woodcutting item from Sumeru yet, but if you have, what do you think about it? If you haven't gotten it yet and haven't heard about it, what would you want a woodcutting item or tool in Genshin to do? So I think I have heard of what you're talking about. I believe Sumeru added a new tool that auto-cuts trees. It like does it every like half minute or something, I think. I don't remember exactly what it does. But where you can basically stand next to a tree and then every so often that tool will automatically gather wood from it. Seems pretty situational, seems pretty difficult to get a lot of wood because I don't know how many trees you have. I guess I would have to get it in the game and see how it really works, but I'm just thinking, like, why wouldn't you just walk up to a tree and then chop it and then run away? You're just gonna stand next to it and then, what, leave your game on for 2 hours to chop the tree down? I don't know. That's something that I'd have to look at, but AFK grinding, I don't like it. I don't like AFK grinding. So if it's a tool that is specifically for AFK grinding, Tiggy not happy with that. Because I don't like AFK grinding, and I also don't like encouraging AFK grinding if we can try to avoid it. But because it's kind of like what I complained about in the last episode about half watching an anime. If you're AFK grinding, are you really playing the game? No, you're not. You're just letting it run while you go off to sleep or do something else. But regardless, I'd have to get it in the game. I don't even know how you get it. I don't know if it's a reward. I'm assuming it's probably a reputation reward, but I have yet to start the Sumeru reputation. But if there was ever an item that I wanted for woodcutting, I can't really think of one, because really, I run up to a tree and whack it and I get wood from it. Maybe an item that like increases your wood gain. Like maybe if that's what the auto cutter does, if that's even what you're talking about, if that's what it does, where like you can cut trees down and auto collect wood from trees while you're doing it, then I guess that is useful. That's kind of like what I'm saying, where maybe there's an item that could increase the amount of wood you get. Because I only get 3 wood logs from a tree. Maybe I could get 6, you know, while having a certain item equipped. I don't know. But moving on, question number 4. Have you considered swapping characters out more often, even if they don't have personal artifacts, just to try more characters? I mean, I don't know if I would do that for, like, just the hell of it. I think I'm just going to do it at the same pace I have been. Okay. There's some random sirens outside. It's like, I don't know about the, like, not, like, doing it even if they don't have personal artifacts, but to try more characters, I think I will do it based on the pace that I have been doing it so far. So every now and then, basically. Question number 5 is, do you ever plan to do a reaction style video to the Genshin character trailers or anything? So we've answered this, I think, in the previous episode, and even maybe this episode. I don't remember if it was the previous or this one, but yes, I would like to do that. I just need to get a hold of a playlist to watch them in order. Number 6 on the question list is, I don't know how interested you are in the Genshin plot and or lore, but what is your personal best guess on what is actually going on in the world of Genshin? Any crackpot conspiracy theories? Boy, I love conspiracy theories. Takes me back to my Higurashi days. Do I have any idea, best guess, my best guess, I don't know if I have a best guess, but what's actually going on in the Genshin world? Fuck if I fucking know. I don't know shit. It's Mass Effect, but Genshin. I don't know. This massive empire just kind of poof, and here we are in the world now, and there's remnants of their empire, and something sussy is going on with this abyss group, and you don't know what the Fatui are up to, but I think that they're always being painted incorrectly. Like, I think they're not actually as evil as the game wants you to think they are. But I have no idea. Like, I genuinely could not guess what's going on right now. Well, they are collecting, like, the Fatui are collecting the gnosises, right, or whatever. So that could have something to do with it. Like, maybe there's gonna be some, I don't know, maybe they're summoning something? I don't know. I literally have no idea of what could or you know, might happen down the road. Like, geez. There's certainly a lot of things I would like to see. I would love to see, like, I was thinking about this earlier. I would like to see a moment where, like, where the climax of the main Archon story, where we have like an Avengers Endgame moment, where all the characters and armies from each nation come together to fight against something, whether that's the Abyss or whatever, including the Fatui being part of the fight, you know, joining in with the rest of the nations. I think that would be awesome to see that, and you just have this huge fucking epic fight. That would be, oh my god, I would die. I think I would literally die on video right there. But I don't really think I have any crackpot conspiracy theories, unfortunately. I haven't really thought about that too much. And going off the information I have, which isn't a lot if you don't look into the lore, which I should probably get around to doing, there is little that I can say I can think of for what might happen in the future of Genshin. Number 7 on the question list is, what do you think about Genshin leaked info, specifically non-story spoiler ones, like upcoming characters and skills? Do you think they are good, bad, or are you indifferent? So, we're talking about leaks, which means they haven't officially announced something or officially shown something off in, like, its own announcement, post, or video. We're talking about people that have a hold of this data or have a hold of this information, and then they go and they start sharing it and posting it online and all that kind of stuff. So I'm not too, I don't care. I don't look at it myself, like, really ever, unless it gets shared to me and I happen to see part of it. But I don't think it's too problematic. But I do think that there is one thing that can be, because this isn't like you specifically say that it's not story spoiler stuff. It's just upcoming characters and skills and the like. So I don't think there's anything wrong with that. It can maybe even go as far to help people decide if they want to save up early for those characters. But the problem I think I have with it is I know that people that do these oftentimes have modded servers or modded worlds for Genshin, and thus the play tests that they do or showcase is really inaccurate to what the final product will be, and a lot of people don't really understand that. So they see these either massive or very low damage numbers, and then that ends up being a negative because they don't realize that a leak or a data mine is not official or finished work. It's an in progress development. That's the only downside I can think of personally. Of course, if you don't want any spoilers, the internet doesn't give a shit about you, and they will not try to slow down on spoilers. So you have to be really careful to try to avoid any kind of spoilers. Even if you consider, like, new characters and their skills and stuff spoilers, you have to still really try to avoid that. Like, I have seen Kusanali's, one of her animations for one of her abilities, and I couldn't avoid it. It literally was just there. It just happened to appear in my face, and it happened so fast I couldn't even blink. So sometimes if you want to avoid that stuff, it's really difficult to do so. So indifferent. I wouldn't even say I'm indifferent. I don't really care. So I wouldn't say they're good or bad, unless, of course, people judge it incorrectly for being not realizing it's in progress work. But I also wouldn't say it's necessarily good. So yeah, I guess I'll say I'm indifferent on it. Don't really mind it myself, but it might affect other people differently. So he goes on to say, number 8.
Wait.
Have you ever had a dream that you you had your you could you'll do you wants you could do so you'll do you could do you want them to do you so much you could do anything? Yes. I absolutely have. Okay, so bouncing to the next question set, which is now posted by Gravile. Green plant dinosaur. 4 days ago, who started by saying, let's have a bunch of questions. So there are 8 questions listed here. So starting with question number 1. Have you watched HoYo versus Genshin concerts yet? If yes, how do you find them? Now I'm assuming by how do you find them as in, did you like them or did you not like them? Not how did you find the video? So I feel really shit all of a sudden. What's happening? 1625. Did I just... What the hell? Oh my god. Okay, hold on. I gotta take a drink. Okay, by these concerts, I assume you're talking about... let me just check, double check here on YouTube. I'm assuming you're talking about, like, where they basically get the whole orchestra together and show live various soundtracks from the game. I'm assuming. So, a Genshin concert. Because I have seen one. I have not seen any more than that one. Although I see that these concerts are like hours long, so perhaps I have not seen the entirety of it. But the only one I have seen is from 1 month ago. And that is the posted by the official Genshin Impact YouTube, the Sumeru Live Symphony Performance. So it's, I guess, not a concert, because I see stuff here like by Genshin Impact, Genshin Concert 2021. So I guess I haven't actually seen a full concert at all, but I've seen a live performance by the musical artists and stuff. So I partially seen something like that, but I guess I would need to look at, like, what have we got here? Oh, well, I can't play it because I don't want you guys hearing the audio. But I would be interested in checking one out, because one of the best aspects of Genshin Impact is its soundtrack, like, period. Like, just straight out. You know, outside of everything else I love about the game and the exploration being an important part of it for me, the soundtrack is oozing. And I have been very dedicated to music for a long time, and the soundtrack in a game is very important to me, including movies. Soundtrack in anything is very important to me. In a game, it's incredibly important to me because I am playing the experience, and the music can really enhance the experience. If you don't care about that type of thing, then you don't really have anything to worry about. But Genshin Impact has one of those soundtracks where it's fully orchestrated, and it is orchestrated by talented-ass people. The music's written by a talented person. It's incredible music. So I would love to watch a live concert at some point. I don't know really anything about where I would go to do that, but well, I can see some of them on here. I just don't know what one I would watch. But chances are I would find them very, very good, because if it's anything like the music in the game, just being performed live, where I get to see the real people perform that shit, hell yeah, it's going to be awesome. Number 2, what's your current favorite male and female character design-wise? Oh boy, okay, so again, I said earlier that I have been planning to do a whole video where I break down the characters' designs and judge them, and basically give ratings on them and stuff, and pick apart all the details I like or don't like. But, so take what I'm going to say with a grain of salt, because I will give you just kind of a general, like, oh yeah, this character I really like the look of, or... Fuck. What the hell's that sound? You know, or this character I really like the look of. But don't take that as being the only thing. Like, don't say, if I say, like, you know, this character, don't assume that that's the character I think is the best looking. Because I really need to sit and break this down to get a full opinion on it. But I will open up a list of characters here, and I will look, and I will tell you, but I wish that this was in-game, because that would really help me out. So I'll pick male character first. So let me just get a general... Fuck off, dude. So some characters are pretty simple, and some characters are pretty complex in how they're designed and how their outfits are designed. And then my throat makes a noise. Thank you, throat. So there's not as many male characters that I think have interesting outfits, but some of them do. So let me just grab a couple here. So some of the male outfits that I've seen that I really like, though I can't say are my favorite, is I really like Diluc's or Diluc's outfit, and I also really like Zhongli's outfit, just base outfit. If I had to pick the male characters, those two. They've got these very almost formal-looking attire. Well, maybe not Diluc so much, but Zhongli definitely has like sort of these long, flowing like overcoats that they have. And their head is not covered by anything, which I had explained in the beginning of the other video that I didn't like Razor's outfit because he has this like bellend-looking hood over him, so it's like this big blob that I'm playing with anytime I'm watching behind him. Because you have to remember, when you're playing a third-person game, you are most frequently looking at the ass of whoever you're playing, right? So when I just get to see, I don't get to see their cool hairstyle or their awesome outfit, I just get to see a hood, it's not as enjoyable for me. Because yes, that does matter to me. But if I had to pick female character, there are quite a few more options, but I think I'm pretty confident in the female character that I have, that I like the most design-wise. But some choices would be, for example, I love how Yunjin is designed. I love her outfit. I love her colors. I love her headdress. I really think she looks awesome, and I love her hairstyle. No, because of course we're not just talking outfit, we're talking hairstyle. And again, when I do that breakdown video, I would be looking at eye color and, you know, eye shape and eyelashes and hair and hairstyle and colors, etc. But I really like pretty much her whole form. I love everything from her hair. Very awesome. I'm very, very attracted to Eastern style short hair, like bobs, Asian bobs and Asian cuts and stuff like that. I don't like, you know, butched or shaved. That's too short for me. But the types of hairstyle that these characters have oftentimes really get me going. However, there is one character that I think is probably taking the ball as far as my favorite design is concerned. And, well, let me just reread the question, because the question is your favorite male and female character design wise. So design wise, I would probably have to choose the Raiden Shogun, because she is just, her outfit is incredible. Her very traditional Japanese style of uniform that she's got on, that is obviously been Genshinified and animefied. But her hair, I'm not too big on that long hair, but she has it braided, and it has like this specific dark violet color with these like bluish purple hues in it, like these lines of shade in it, which really just, I don't know, I love that color. I mean, my favorite color is blue. And so anything on that side of the color palette, so dark blues, purples, etc., those colors are really gorgeous. She has these beautiful purple eyes. I love her little tassels she's got all over her. Everything about her design, I think, is what I would consider to be perfect, in quotations, since everything meshes extremely well with them. Of course, this isn't what I would consider my magnum opus as far as character design would be concerned. If I was designing a character, she would have horns. She would have animal ears or something along those lines, you know. She would have probably a slightly different color palette. But honestly, just looking at, I mean, there are plenty of other female characters and male characters too that have really nice designs. I'm just trying to pick off the top of my head my favorite ones. Like, I really like Ayaka's like armor on her dress, how her dress has armor on it. Like, that I really like the look of too. I really love her headpiece that she's got as well. But I think overall, as an entire package, the closest I would come, if I had to pick, like, between, it would be a very close call between the Raiden Shogun, elements of Ningguang, and Noelle. Because, I mean, she's a battle maid. Dude, battle maids are awesome. And I love Noelle's hair, and I love the roses she's got in her hair, and I love Ningguang's just elegance. I love the little pokey things she's got on her hand. I love her eyes, especially in that uniform, or not uniform, but that outfit that you can get for her, that blue flowing dress. I really love that as well. So elements of all three of these characters I like, but I think I'll pick the Raiden Shogun as my favorite. Okay, so moving on with question number 3, what's your current favorite male and female character, personality or story-wise? Again, unfortunately, I don't know everyone's story, so it's not entirely fair for me to just, you know, pick this one and say this is my favorite when I don't know everyone else's story or backstory or anything like that. And I don't know everyone's personality either. I especially don't know the male personalities outside of, like, Archon Quest, because I haven't played with any of the characters. You know, so I don't think I can pick a favorite male character. Although, actually, I think Arataki Ito. I think he's probably, if I had to pick, like, he seems really, I don't know, he's always fun. Anytime I've been messing around with him in, like, events and stuff, he's always seemed like a pretty fun guy. You know, and hey, we've got fun guy in the game now, so it makes total sense, but maybe I'll pick him, mainly because I don't know anyone else, really, you know? I mean, there are certainly some that I know, but I'm not too big on their personality. Like, I don't really like Sino's personality. Doesn't mean I dislike him as a character, I'm just saying it's not my favorite. Like, D-Luke, I'm not too big into. Albedo, I'm not too big into, from what I know about their personality. Kazuha, I like his story. I like his backstory because it's more tragic, and that's more interesting to me. But again, I don't really like his personality. I'm looking to see if there's any other notable male characters that I care to talk about. It's Tartaglia, Mr. Water Guy. Zhongli was kind of funny with the whole money thing. But yeah, I think I'll settle on Ito. Just the little that we've had with him, he was always really fun to be messing around with. Now, as far as female characters concerned, oh boy, where do we start? Well, I could list off, so favorite female character personality-wise. Man, it's a close call. One of the first ones that pops to my head immediately is Ayaka. For the same reason I had explained in the last episode, where Ayaka seems to just be, she has all this responsibility, but she has so much care for, like, you, and wanting to get to know you better, and, like, she's totally the type of person that would unsheath her sword to protect you. That's the type of person she is. Noelle, I love her personality, but I think she's a little bit too much of being, you know, the dutiful battle maid. I think that the idea of always wanting to serve is a good aspect of her personality. It's just, I think they went a little bit too, it's kind of like Bennett, right? See, Bennett has, his whole trope is that he's clumsy, but they're too on the nose with it that it isn't really interesting to me anymore, because it's always, oh, I tripped over this, or I fell on my ass, or I broke this, or that, you know, it's always too on the nose, in my opinion. And I feel like, as much as I like Noelle, her whole wanting to serve is just about as on the nose, but her design and everything else makes up for that. And she's also very, very kind, so that's another aspect that I would like about her. I'm trying to think about other characters that... Sucrose. Oh, man. Okay. Yeah, I think... And I like Miko's Dami Mami side. If I needed to pick a favorite character personality-wise for female, it's Sucrose. And it's probably because... Well, she's a brainiac, right? So she's very smart, and she's always wanting to experiment. but she's very shy. She's very difficult in social situations, which makes her very relatable to me. And thus, I loved how she's always soft and quiet, and she's always shy, and she's always kind of a little bit skittish. And the fact that, like, in the recent Mondstadt event where she jolts away so she doesn't have to meet Razor and stuff, you know, I thought that was really funny and cute because that's totally the shit I would be doing. So yeah, I'll settle on Ito for male character right now, and I'll settle on Sucrose for female character personality-wise. Okay, so the next question is, as far as I know, you don't watch any Genshin trailers, whether that's story or character trailers, right? Which is correct. I know a bunch of other Genshin content creators who react to their character, to the character trailers, and then try to rank them on how well made and cool they are. Would you ever be interested in doing something like that? So again, we've addressed this partially, although he asks specifically, about how I would about ranking them. Again, I would gladly react to these, and I would probably do some sort of ranking as well. I don't know how really I would set that up until I started doing it, though. But yes, I would be interested in at least reacting to them, and then we can worry about ranking ever at some point afterwards. So question number 5 is a less... Excuse me. I need to take a drink. My throat's dying, man. Number 5, a less Genshin-related question and more personal one. I remember when you first met Venti and Goro, you called them kinda cute, so I was curious. On a scale from 0 to 10, how interested would you say you are in other guys in general? Or are Venti and Goro just cute anime guy exceptions? No need to answer this question if it's a little too personal. It's not too personal at all. I mean, it is personal, but it's not too personal to me. An interesting question. So, I kind of talked about my whole relationship thing recently in the previous episode, but I had explained that I had never really had any of that during my whole life. I have been, for a period of time, was bi-curious. Which, because I had found myself being attracted to different aspects of men, despite being a guy myself. Here's the thing, right? You know, I'll try to be as straightforward as I can so that I don't beat around any bushes here. If I had to put on a scale of 0 to 10, how interested would I say I'm in other guys in general, as far as, like, you know, a romantic sense, I don't know, 4, 5 maybe a little bit lower. The thing is in order for me, like, I can totally appreciate when a guy looks great, right? Because I can see, oh wow, the guy's hot, you know, or that guy's cute. The thing is in order for me to, say, become attracted or even more sexually attracted, the guy has to have a feminine esque personality or, like, visual outgoing self. So, I mean, that might be why I look at certain characters in Genshin Impact and think that sort of way. Like, Venti looks very feminine to me. I just hate his personality. So, that is not somebody I would really be able to be friends with. I do swing for, you know, the team of being with the opposite sex, but if a guy's cute, I can't deny that I can be turned on by it. And I mean that as in I have been, not just I could be, I have been, so I can confirm that is a possibility. But if I'd ever be able to, you know, hold a long-lasting relationship with a guy, I don't know. That's something, as is bi-curious, I'd have to try, because I've never tried it, so at least not in a traditional sense, so I wouldn't know entirely until such a thing would happen. So I'd say maybe a 4, maybe a little bit lower. Yes, Goro and Venti are cute anime guys, but at the same time, it comes from a very specific place. And that's how I feel about these types of things. So, yeah, and you won't get any judgments from me, like, in general, anybody that's, if you're a guy and you're into guys and only guys, or if you're a girl and you're into girls and only girls, there's no judgment there at all. I am totally up for being attracted to whomever or whatever you want, right? So you don't have to worry about that, me being any harsh on that kind of stuff. Okay, so number 6 is, what Genshin character do you think you would absolutely hate to be around, either because of their personality or because of personal safety reasons? Man, I would not care if it was personal safety reasons. Like, I guess Klee would be that option because she's blowing shit up all the time. But if I could get blown up by Klee, that'd be an awesome way to go out. But is there a character I absolutely hate to be around? Venti. I would not stand being around Venti. At least his English version. And it's not even just a classical sense of, I don't like the English voice acting. It is, I literally cannot stand his personality. That really arrogant, just, I cannot stand Venti at all. Anytime he shows up in a quest, I'm always like rolling my eyes. I'm not looking forward to spending time. I think in the recent Vine Lace Fest festival or whatever it was called, I think Venti was annoying as fuck until he did his bard song, which I actually enjoyed. But otherwise, yeah, absolutely easy to answer. Venti would be the character I could not be around because of their personality. A character I couldn't be around because of safety reasons, probably Klee. But then again, Klee seems like the most fun little girl to play with, right? I mean, she's always talking about like finding weird lizards and stuff, or running around in the rain with her waterproof bombs, or blowing up fish and getting fish food. Like, dude, that kind of shit doesn't happen in Wisconsin. I need some more excitement in my life. Anyways, moving on to number 7. What's the worst injury you've ever had? Oh boy, let me think about that. So I have never, I'm assuming you mean injury as in general, not like just broken bones, like just any injury I've ever had, whether it was an accident or not. Here's the thing, I've never broken a bone. I'm 23. I don't know how old I am. I've broken a bone. I've never broken a bone before, so I don't know what that's like. So you don't have to expect me to say, oh, my, when I broke my arm that time. I'm trying to think here. So there was two things that the closest I've ever come to like anything was an injury. Like, would you consider an infection an injury? Because I don't know if you can, because there was a time I had an infected toe back in 2013. Well, we talked about 2013 like multiple times already. But my toe became infected. There was I don't mean to get too graphic, but I had a what we call a blood blister, which is basically like a little bubble of blood that formed. And it went away, and the whole big toe on my right foot had, like, the whole side of it had poofed up. It had swollen. And I was like, oh my god, you know, I didn't know what was really going on. And then over time, a little disgusting open wound had formed between the crease of the skin and the nail, right? You know, like where you get like hangnails, it was in there. And that was the worst injury I've had, because I had to go to the hospital and I had to take antibiotics for it. And the way that they cleaned it, the nurse had cleaned it, she was very clearly not good at doing her job. because imagine it like a hangnail. You know how a hangnail will pull up and back if you, you know, brush against it? So you have to brush the opposite direction so that it doesn't do that. Well, she brushed the direction you shouldn't go, and she was brushing with force, creating friction against the open wound when she was cleaning it, rather than doing like dabbing it, you know, or brushing in the right direction really gently. And she was not doing it gently. That was incredibly painful to go through. I remember sitting in the chair in the hospital, and I was just wincing with so much pain, squeezing the thing, and she looked up and kind of jokingly said, "Just breathe." And I'm like, "Bitch, don't tell me to breathe when you are like basically jabbing your fingernails into my open wound that's oozing pus and all this other gross stuff." And then of course I had to treat it, where like every day for a certain amount of time, I think multiple times a day, I had to soak the foot in warm soapy water for a certain period of time, and then I needed to have it wrapped individually every time, and then the bandages needed to be replaced. It was so much inconvenience and work, and I needed to sleep with the foot being above my my chest, like if I was sleeping on my back, the foot needed to be raised up. And it was like, dude, oh my God, right? Again, I don't know if you'd consider that an injury because it was an infection, but it was very painful and very inconvenient for a period of my life back then. And that's about the worst it's gotten as far as like injury is concerned. Now, I don't know if I should really talk about this. I don't mean to like get dark. The other closest I've ever had with any kind of injury was self-harm, where I used to cut myself, and it wasn't pretty, and I did my right hand in really badly a couple years ago, and it is, the whole top of my hand has basically a layer of scarring over it. It's not like super obvious, like burn scars or anything, but if you were to look at my hand under a light, you would see all of the scar marking from when this had occurred. And if you brush your hand over it and then brush your hand over like my left hand, you would notice how smooth and rough the difference is just because of this extra layer of scarring that's on top of it. That's about all I can say as far as injury is concerned. So I'm trying to think. I mean, there were times where like I got really bad bruises from stepping on stuff, but nothing ever that did any permanent damage or any real serious damage. But then again, you know, people talk about walking outside and they step off the curb and then suddenly, you know, their whole hip shatters. So who knows? Maybe someday I'll just die by walking outside. So maybe I should stay inside. No. Oh, it's getting, like, rainy out. Anywho, the next question, in fact, the final question that they have is, do you or have you ever played Dungeons & Dragons? I'm trying to keep, like, everything gender neutral here because I don't know if the people asking questions are male or female, and I don't want to make anyone angry because I've made people angry about Venti in the past, where I thought Venti was a girl and then I talked about Venti having a penis and then everyone got pissed off. Not everyone, but there was multiple people that have commented about that, not being happy about it. Anyways, question number 8 was, do you or have you ever played Dungeons & Dragons? I have not, but it is something that I can see myself actually having a shitload of fun with. Dungeons & Dragons, now, I don't know much about it, so obviously I'm just talking this with some ignorance here, but it seems like the type of thing that you need a big imagination for, and I personally feel like I have a big imagination. It's one of those things I didn't get rid of when I grew up. And, because you hear so many adults talk about how, you know, oh, you know, no, having an imagination is only for children, basically, right? And, I mean, I even ranted about this in one of my recent Genshin videos when I was talking about candy and how, you know, it's like, fuck you, I didn't matter if I'm an adult, I can still like candy, man. And I feel like that's the same thing with imagination. I don't know what's so bad about having an imagination as an adult. I think that's great, you know, being able to do that type of thing. I mean, there's a lot of things that has carried over from when I was a child that I think are still so awesome to have around today, imagination being one of them. But Dungeons & Dragons seems like a really fun romp if I were to ever sit down in a session of that. Of course, that requires you to be social. It's raining. And being social is difficult for me. So maybe someday I'll get to experience it. I don't know. I guess we'll have to sit down and see someday. But it is something that I have been interested in. Anyways, I think that's about it for, yeah, that's all 8 questions posted by this person. So I am probably going to continue, but I'm going to cut the video, or I'm not going to cut the video here, but I'm going to cut the audio here because my throat is starting to kill me. So I will have to finish this later on my own time, but I'm going to splice it together for this, just this one video. So as far as how many questions we have left, let's see, we still got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, dude, 10. Okay, we have 10 different, it looks like we have 10 people left, and each one of them pretty much has a multi-question list of stuff. There's not really anybody else in here that has just a single question. So, oh no, okay, no, I take that back. There is one single question. Then we got a two question, then a four part question, a fucking 10 part question. Holy shit, a 9 part question, a 4 part question, another single question, a 6 part question, a 5 part question. A two-part question. Okay, so we still got quite a bit to do, but I think we can cover it in the next part of this. So I gotta rest my throat, man.
All right, welcome back. I am back, and we should be continuing almost immediately after the last clip ended. So without further ado, let's go. I went to sleep, so that should have refreshed my throat a little bit, hopefully. But I might sound a little bit groggy here for just a minute. Take a drink, a new drink. And unfortunately, after taking that little break, my comments have, like, freaking shuffled. So now I have to make sure I look through and didn't miss one. So I think, who was the last person that I read off questions from? Yes, I don't know. Somebody. There are now new comments in between. Next on the edge. So I guess we'll just continue by, I'll name, yeah, here we go. Here's some smaller questions that have been asked and kind of now shuffled into the area I already read. But we'll start off with Andrew Tedor's questions, two questions. What are your thoughts on Genshin's main plot, the Archon quests? Oh boy, okay. Let me see here. So, thankfully, I am caught up on the Archon story. I'm up to wherever Sumeru's story left off, Act 4, I think. So, I do have the ability to talk a little bit better about this than I would have if, you know, we were a few hundred episodes back. Let me see. How do I feel about the Archon story? So, I think I made it pretty clear a long time ago that I thought the story was pretty cool, like in Mondstadt, but I didn't think it was anything special, because I even vividly remember getting a negative comment saying that I basically don't have the right to have any opinion on the Mondstadt Archon story because I haven't played the rest of the Archon story, which I don't think makes any sense when each piece of the Archon story is its own chapter connected to one another but focused on a certain region. And I do still feel that way, you know, thinking back after getting to see most of the rest of the game, I do still look back and think, yeah, the Mondstadt story is probably the weakest as far as it all goes. And I mean, you could argue and say that, well, that's probably because it's where the Archon story starts, which is fair. The Liyue story is, well, the climax, specifically, the fight with the big sea creature, multi-headed sea creature, that is just fucking dope. It's probably the most epic moment in the entire story so far. And then, of course, Inazuma, and then the chasm, and then Sumeru. Well, to be fair, again, I don't really remember too much about the rest of Liyue's story, but for Inazuma, this was the first time where we got to see kind of bigger scale stuff, not counting the fight with the big sea monster, because we got to see, you know, we got to see two armies clash at one point. We got to see kind of the inner workings of a resistance fighting against a powerful foe. And of course, the Inazuma storyline was where we got to see the Shogun kick ass and kill somebody on screen. Well, dissolve them into nothingness. But somebody died, which of course is something I've been asking for a long time, because I like more mature and darker stories. So that was really awesome. The chasm was not great. I'd have to say that as far as all of them are concerned, the chasm is my least favorite piece of the Archon story so far. I did like the plot twist that the Hilichurls are like Conryon citizens from ages ago, and they've been cursed and all this. What I did not like about it was, first of all, it was pretty short, but It like tried to make you feel bad for the Hill of Churls, and then the travelers is like all, you know, like, oh my god, you know, and all this crap, and it's like, dude, we never cared about the Hill of Churls before. Now suddenly I'm supposed to care about them, and then I'm gonna turn around tomorrow and go out and slaughter hundreds, if not thousands, of Hill of Churls. It's not gonna make a single difference on the traveler or myself. And I wasn't too big on that. Like, it kind of created this player-made plot hole or whatever. But at least there was a neat plot twist. But Sumeru, wow, that story really got me involved so far. You mean you're going all over the place in that? You're going to the desert. You're going to the city. You're stuck in the city. You're going all over the place. And I really loved the story in Sumeru City because the one where, you know, the day is repeating itself, but time outside of that day is still moving on, because it really reminded me, I mean, it's like the first time in the whole series, in the whole whole game, where it's really a mystery story, and I love mysteries so much. It almost took me back to, like, the feeling I got when I watched Higurashi for the first time, because I'm trying to figure out what's going on, and then you get a little bit more detail the next time around, and you get a little bit more detail, you know, and I'm like, okay, maybe this is happening. And then you find out that your whole theory is just incorrect. So you have to tear that down and create a new one. I'd have to say as a whole, I'm pretty excited for where the plot is going to be going. It started off pretty weak, I'll say. But still neat, not bad, just pretty weak. And then it got better, 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 then kind of dipped, and then got really good with Sumeru's story. So, I mean, even if they left it on the level it is now, I would love to see more dark stuff, like we saw in Inazuma. But yeah, I'm pretty happy with where the plot is right now, and I'm pretty happy to see where it's going to be going. Now, number two on this question list is, what do you like most about being a content creator? Well, I wouldn't necessarily call myself a content creator. It's not a professional business that I'm working in. But what do I like most? Just being able to do whatever the hell I want, basically. I can play any game I want, I can record any game I want, and I can record those memories. That's, you know, one of the biggest parts about my channel is being able to keep everything that I've recorded in one place and be able to look back on it. And then there's people out there that find enjoyment from that, and they too can look back on it years and years later. Still have, you know, people that will rewatch a certain series of mine, which is awesome, because that's how I watch my favorite Let's Players, is I'll rewatch a lot of their Let's Plays. I mean, I've got Super Mario Sunshine from Nintendo Capri Sun right now in my my tabs open, because I've been rewatching that playthrough for like the 80th time. So I'd say, like, probably that what I like most is just being able to kind of do what I want and express myself the way that I want, until the internet gets its hooks into me, and then I try to be canceled 4 or 5 times. This is the way the internet works. We'll see how that goes. But that's probably what I'd have to say. I mean, I don't earn a lot of money from doing this, so it's not my job. I can't make a living. I don't make a living off of my YouTube. I earn basically spending cash from the videos I make. It would be awesome to have a job like this, though, where you do earn enough to live off of by just doing basically something you love to do and have a lot of fun doing. Okay, so that's it for Andrew's questions. Now we're going to move on to Mr. Islam's questions. I don't want to fuck up the first name a little bit too much, so single question here, which is actually three questions. Are you liking the new changes in alternate sprint, for example Ayaka and Mona? So up to this point I have uploaded my Chasm playthrough, and in that I do equip Ayaka and try out her alternate sprint, and it was like night and day difference. I noticed it immediately that Ayaka was not getting stuck on every little pebble, and that she was not getting stuck on rocks or like ledges that other characters can just walk off of. She wasn't getting stuck on any of that shit. So I am absolutely loving the new changes, because that was one of the worst parts about Ayaka when I played with her, was that she would get stuck on the smallest things, and it would either make it impossible to dodge sometimes, or when you're trying to get to a better position, you get stuck on everything, or whatever. So I'm very happy to see that they finally implemented some changes there to help it fix that. The next question is, have you started artifact farming? Now, I don't know if, like, this person doesn't watch my series in like, its full, but I've already done artifact grinding. Now, maybe they're asking more specifically, do you just live and breathe artifact grinding, which is not what I do. But when I need artifacts for somebody, I will grind a domain for a certain determined amount of time, and I will try to get different artifacts. So in that regard, yes, I have been artifact farming, but if you're talking about, like, spending every day and all of your resin on artifact grinding just to get that one good piece for, you know, weeks and weeks, months, or whatever on end, no, I have not. That's definitely not the way I want to play the game if I can help it. And last but not least, the third question is, will you summon for Nahida or Kusanali? Yeah. Duh, I'm absolutely going to be summoning for her because she's adorable. I think she's really cute. And I think she comes after Nilo's, which actually should be starting today, that banner. I think she's coming after that. And of course, if you saw my recent pull episode, I was able to save about 40 of my pulls after getting Sino, the 5-star. So I'll probably do some pulls on Nilo's banner and then see how much I can gather up and hope that I can do some pulls on Kusanali's banner. If I can't do enough to do both Nilo and Kusanali, then I will probably make the decision to not pull for Nilo and save everything for Kusanali because I really want her most. Okay, so that's it for those questions. Now let me see here. I gotta make sure. So that was... Yeah, okay, so we got some new ones down there. Let me make sure that nothing's shuffled in down here. We switching? We talked about Mark's questions. Yeah, we talked about that. Mm-hmm. I think we talked about that.
We're way behind schedule.
Okay, I think we are... We have the last batch of questions all round up here. Okay, so now we're going to answer questions from Pipe Dream, who has been subscribed to me for a year, probably since I started Genshin. I haven't looked at everyone else's subscription times. 1 year. 1 year. It's like everyone who's posting comments on my Genshin video is a Genshin viewer that was around from the days I started Genshin. Okay, anyway, so Pipe Dream's questions, which are about four. So they start off by saying, I think some of the other comments already asked some of these questions, but whatever. So the first question is, would you be interested in watching Genshin trailers, demos, teasers anytime soon? Or maybe even collected miscellanies? The first ones obviously give more lore and characteristics of the characters, and the collected miscellanies are focused more on their gameplay narrated by the one and only Mr. Dane, mostly. So they can have a bit of lore every now and then. So obviously we've already addressed this, although we didn't have anybody say anything about whatever these collected miscellanies are. Just to recap again, yes, I would react to those and have a look at each one of them. I just need to have an organized playlist to work from first. So moving on to the second question. I'm assuming by this point you're up to date with the Sumeru Archon quest. As of right now, 3.1, what would you want to see happen in the future updates, or the end of the Archon quest in 3.2 and forward? Obviously this is Genshin we're talking about, so not everything is possible, but in your opinion, what would be nice to see happening? Wow, okay. It's difficult for me to make a decision on what I would like to see happen by the end of 3.2, because that's a bit short term. So I would probably have to look further into the distance. Well, I kind of already talked a little bit about this before. I would love to have, at some point in the Archon story, a sort of Avengers Endgame scenario where everybody comes together, all these different characters and armies and everything come together for a big showdown against something, whether it's a massive monster or, you know, the Abyss or whatever, because I don't know enough about the Abyss to know, you know, what their plans are, what their
how evil they are or whatever. And I've already said before that I firmly believe that the Fatui are not as evil as the game's making us believe. You know, anytime you're able to address what the Fatui are up to, you can only ever pick, they are the bad guys in the dialogue options. They always force you to pick something like that. You can never really pick anything else or whatever you might be really thinking. But I think there's something else going on with the Fatui, and we just don't know it yet. Probably we'll know it once we get closer to Sneznaya being released into the game. But yes, I am obviously up to date with the Sumeru Archon quest as of right now. I would also really like to see something about space. Okay, maybe that's going too far, but for whatever reason, I'm like obsessed with the idea of going to the moon in Genshin, but I mean, that might be a little bit too far, you know, up there. I really just want to see more regions added to the game right now, you know, and get a continuation of the story. I want to see how big the world can really get. I want to just see it keep going and expanding. But story-wise, I want a massive fight at some point. And of course, I would also say the obligatory, I would like something dark to happen. We already saw a character get killed. Let's see it happen again. Let's see a whole city get wiped out. Okay, well, I liked what they did with the Shogun and Signora. I'd like to see something else like that too happen. So number three on the question is, what's your favorite region between the big regions like Sumeru, Liyue, Inazuma, and Mondstadt so far, and why? So specifically big regions, not Dragon Spine or the Chasm. Yes, the Chasm is part of Liyue, but I consider it a special sub-region. So what is my favorite region? Oh boy, let's see. Frozen. What is my favorite region? What the fuck? Freshness preserved. Now there is no other. There is no other clarification on like based on your favorite soundtrack or based on your favorite like quest line. It's just favorite region. So I'm gonna probably go based off of. Because the thing is I like every region in some way, every region I like. But my favorite, I'm gonna have to say visually, it would be Inazuma. And that's not just because of its Japanese aesthetic, it's the color palette. Because at Inazuma, everything has a very blue hue to it. Everything's either blue, pink, or purple, or like a deep violet or indigo color. Yet like the greens always look kind of blue, they're like bluish green. I mean, look at Watatsumi Island. For example, what the fuck? Whoever designed that shit deserves their favorite meal every day for the rest of their life, right? Because that place is just gorgeous to look at. Beautiful colors, beautiful visuals. The only downside is that it's all islands. It's all scattered islands. So exploring it, getting to each island can be a little bit annoying sometimes, and kind of be inconvenient and break up the pace of exploration. But at the same time, I would argue that sometimes having islands makes exploration easier to keep track of because you're able to, it's already sanctioned off. Instead of having a giant continent, you know, to try to figure out, okay, I've been here, here, and here, but I haven't been here. You can just look and say, oh, island one, island two, island three, let's explore island two, and you'll be able to keep track of that until it's complete. And then you can say, okay, island three, we're gonna explore now. So in that regard, I'd say it's actually more convenient, but it is still, to get around, it can be a little bit inconvenient. So visually, yeah, I would pick Inazuma, but I do love locations like Mondstadt and Liyue, and of course Sumeru has the desert, and the desert is probably my favorite biome in the game currently. So it's a toss-up, but I haven't explored the desert enough to really say if I like it more than, you know, a place like Inazuma. Color-wise, Inazuma is more beautiful, in my opinion. But the desert is gorgeous, too. So, I don't know. I'd have to give it more time. But that's where I would say right now, as of the making of this video, that's how I feel about my favorite region. Of course, if we're talking about other aspects that don't just regard how it looks visually, Sumeru is probably my favorite region. Based on like gameplay mechanics, it's a lot more convenient to get around there. They've implemented like the new animals where when you can, you know, they have actual health bars, and when you kill them they drop shitloads of meat, like the scorpions in the desert or the vultures or the big like wild cats or those giant like yak creature things. I always forget what they're called. You know, I don't think any other region had animals that had health bars in their own attack patterns and stuff, so that was really awesome to see. And of course, it's just beautiful to have this really rich green area bordering a brown desert. So, mechanic-wise, I'd say probably Sumeru, which I would expect considering it's the newest region. So I would imagine them to have the most refined content out of them all. And when you look back on Mondstadt, you can see that it's probably the weakest mechanically compared to every other region, because it's where the game basically started. So the fourth question is, did you ever expect your Genshin LP to reach 700 episodes already? LOL. Honestly, I like how you say that in the comment, but now we're like up to 800 episodes. Honestly, when I started in January 2021, at first, no. I expected it to be a game that, you know, grabbed me by the balls, because it did. But did I expect it to reach hundreds and hundreds of episodes? No, I didn't even expect it to kick off. I just thought, you know, a couple people would watch it, because it was just, I was told, hey, you know, it's a free-to-play game, why not give it a try? And so I did, and then it kicked off, and it became my most popular series by views. And then, of course, the game really grabbed me by the balls, and I kept playing it, and kept playing it, and kept playing it, and kept playing it, and kept playing it. And I got to 100, 200, 300, 400, 500 episodes. And then we got to 600 episodes, I think, by the end of 2021 or the beginning of 2022. And then we broke 700 episodes just this month. And now we've basically broken 800 episodes. Now, of course, episodes went by faster in the past because I used to record by average about 30 to 35 minutes per episode, sometimes shorter, and rarely ever longer. But now my recordings are longer, so now on average it's 50 minutes to an hour, sometimes longer, sometimes shorter, so that's why the episode numbers don't go up as fast as they used to. That's why it looks like I've only, you know, done 100 or 200 episodes this year, but in reality it's because the episode lengths are so much greater. So I'd say probably about a quarter of the way or halfway into my experience with Genshin so far, I probably said, yeah, I would have expected the LP to reach this far. Because, I mean, I used to have up on my whiteboard when I would record Genshin, I would have other series, other LPs of mine that were written down, and how many episodes they had, like Final Fantasy XIV or Deep Rock Galactic, and I'd be like, Genshin's catching up, and then Genshin overtook them all. You know, so I was definitely keeping an eye on how fast I was getting episodes out. But to finish off, they say, I think that's all for me, but I might edit if I come up with something else. Considering that this comment was 4 days ago and has not been edited, I guess they did not come up with something else. But there were some fun questions in there, so let's continue on with the next set of questions. So let me see, let me bounce down now, see if I can figure out whose questions are coming up next. Okay. So the next questions are by Hitori, who posted 3 days ago with, it looks like, two questions. Let me just have a look here. Okay, making sure that I have the whole thing cropped out. So the first question is, do you have any Genshin YouTubers you watch? To say it as simply, no, I do not. But it's not because I don't like the Genshin YouTubers or anything like that. It's literally just because I don't watch other people play Genshin Impact. There have been Genshin videos I have watched by content creators that make Genshin content, but I've never, like, dedicated my time to watching more of their series or more of their videos. And like I said, it's not because I don't like Genshin YouTubers, it's just because I don't really do that type of thing very often anymore. When I was younger, I used to always look up Let's Plays, all the time. Whenever I would be into a game I don't have yet, or whenever I would be, I'd get a game and I would be loving it, I would look up this game, you know, Let's Play this game. And then I would start watching whoever would pop up first or whatever, and then that's how I would find new people that I would enjoy watching. But as the years went on, I started doing that less and less, and I started sticking to the people that I knew I liked. So some of the old school LPers, and part of that is because Let's Plays have changed a lot over the years, and I feel like a lot of the core meaning of what Let's Plays used to be has been lost, and that's not something that I enjoy very much myself. So I tend to do that less and less, and now I just pretty much don't do it at all. But also because Genshin YouTubers may cover content that I have not covered yet. But of course, this could change someday. Maybe someday I can sit down and watch somebody play the game for the first time. I don't know, we'll see. It's just, when I watch Let's Plays, I like to watch LPs that are basically the same format. Excuse me, what the hell? That are basically the same format as the LPs I make. I don't want to sit down and watch an LP that cuts out hours of footage just because it's resource gathering. I want to see that stuff if I have the option to. And unfortunately, that's something that a lot of people just cut out. Now, this is not the same as, say, you know, my history with being part of the War Thunder community, where I used to be a War Thunder content creator and a War Thunder partner in the partnership program, where I would used to watch various War Thunder content creators, and I would get to know them, and we would do stuff together and all that kind of stuff. But I would slow down and stop watching because it felt like I was the only person on the planet who was looking out for, you know, the little guy, and not just being, hey, I'm a YouTube partner with War Thunder, everything about War Thunder is great, and I get a lot of bonuses to say stupid shit about the game that's not true, and hey, I'm going to support this anti-community bullshit in the game with this YouTube Cup event or whatever, you know, whatever, just all these various different things. And I started getting sick of seeing every goddamn fucking YouTuber do that. And they would blast up to 100,000 subscribers or more, or 50,000 subscribers, and of course, there was a piece of envy there for me because I felt like I was speaking the truth and being on the side of the community, yet I wasn't getting any rewards for it. I was watching everyone else just basically stroke Gaijin's dick, and they would go shoot so far up, and, well, I didn't like that aspect of the community, which is why I dropped out of the War Thunder content creating community. I still make it just casually now, but it's not my sole focus anymore. Thankfully, that is not what happens with Genshin. That is absolutely not. It's literally just, I don't watch them. Just don't. You know, there's no other reason in there as to why. Anyway, so question number two is, how was your day? Has the unpleasant work environment settled down, or did you quit? So obviously I did talk about this in my series already, in the Genshin LP, but they go on to say specifically that they don't really keep up with the newer episodes. So as for my unpleasant work environment, it was settling down, and then it got even worse, basically, as the year got closer to the end. And so I walked out of my job, I think it was on November 2nd or 3rd, it was one of those days. Like, I had basically given an ultimatum the previous day, and then when I came in, they had completely disregarded basically anything, and had pretty much made the bad situation worse. And so I said, I'm sick of this, you know. So I walked out with the intention of not coming back. I did not officially quit, but I did walk out with the intention of quitting. And I think it was like a week later or whatever. I was called about, you know, to make sure, you know, if I'm coming back to work or whatever. And that call, I was like, okay, fine, you know what? I will set up a leave request, and I'll return. And that leave request went through the insurance, and I was set to return, I think, at the end of January 2022. So I would be off work for about 2 months up to that point, because I was not comfortable being in that environment around the holiday with how toxic it was getting, and I had set the leave up specifically under the stress option, which is one of the options you could pick on there. So that went through, and then it was in December, my despite being on a leave of absence, I was terminated from my job officially, even though I was on a leave, which has unironically happened also to my dad recently, who was on a leave for having COVID, and also got terminated from his job during a leave, which seems to just be something that our Walmart just loves doing, regardless, which is just awesome. which I find hilarious because the leave is supposed to protect you from that type of thing. That's what the insurance is there for. But in fine print, it says underneath all the policies that are there to protect employees, it says in fine print, Walmart reserves the right to terminate whoever they need to, you know, whenever they want, basically. Which just begs to ask the question, then what the fuck's the point in having all the stuff to protect, all the policies and things to protect the employee, if you can just say, oh, no, we can still do what we want. It just kind of feels really shady and, like, scummy. But it is a corporation, so what do you expect? So, long story short, no, I quit. Well, I was technically fired, but I also walked out, so... that's that. But, continuing on with the rest of your question, so this is... I guess this is more of a third question here, which is, oh, how was my day? My day was fine, I slept. But the rest of the questions are, I absolutely loved the first 1 to 100-ish videos, like the Chili Hunt and beyond, there's a callback. That whole event was one of my best moments of Genshin content on YouTube, but sadly I couldn't keep up since it's already 700 episodes plus. It's like One Piece now. Could you please add poll episode on the thumbnail? I have been keeping up with those, though it's hard to spot them. Okay, so, I mean, it makes total sense. I don't ever expect anybody to watch every single video I make, but it is always there for you if you ever want to come back and watch it, you know, 2 years, 3 years, 4 years down the road. Just because I upload 10 videos in a day does not mean you have to watch 10 videos in a day. I've never expected that of everybody. I mean, there used to be people that would complain about how the fuck is anyone supposed to watch this much shit in a single day? Like, who said that was a requirement? Nobody said that was a requirement. It's there whenever you want to watch it. But I totally understand not being able to keep up with 700 episodes, because it is my longest series, and it's probably the longest Genshin series out there right now. So that's understandable and perfectly fine. But as for adding poll episode to the thumbnail, that's probably doable. I don't see why I couldn't do that. Because, I mean... When you're scrolling, I guess, through your subscriber feed or whatever, you're looking through the playlist, your brain is going to see the thumbnail, and while each picture is different, you'll notice the title and the number is kind of always in the same place, so your brain formulates this, hey, I'm looking at the same image as I flip through these, but if your brain picks up on something like poll episode in the thumbnail, it's going to immediately be like, oop, something's different here, aha, there it is, making it easier to spot. The only thing I can say is, I don't really have a problem doing that. It's just I already put poll episode in the title, and in the thumbnail itself, the poll episodes are always shown by having, like, one of the wishes, one of the golden wishes or whatever. So I have already made it separated, but I guess maybe those images kind of still meld in with the rest of the series thumbnail, so I can still put poll episode in there. I mean, I've already been doing that with the recent co-op episodes, like 720 to 730 or whatever, where I put placeholder in there because I don't have my partner around to get custom screenshots yet. So I've already put text in thumbnails, so I'm sure I can do that. I might as well give it a try and just see how it goes. You know, it's free. Okay, so that's all of Hitori's questions. So now I will scroll back up and look and see where we are with the second set of questions. Okay, so now we have, let me scroll down, because this person actually posted two sets of questions. Okay, we're coming down to the last few people, except they have a big, they have a lot of big chains of questions. So I'm going to start with Sal's comments here. Or Saul. Sal's is somebody that I believe is on the Discord server, who has posted two separate comment threads on here, or chains rather. So I'm going to read their first one first, because it brought me to their second one first, but I'll read their first set of questions first. But they start off by saying, Sal here, heya. With five questions, starting with question number one. What's your opinion on the element system in Genshin now that the Dendro has been added? Do you think the Dendro element reactions are fitting? What about other elements compared to it? I've heard some people complain that the Geo reactions are being total ass, for example. Any specific changes you would like to make to the current system? Dude, I don't fucking know. I'm not a metagamer to know anything about that shit. I just do the reactions that I see do the big PP damage all the time. I have never experienced really the Geo reaction with Dendro myself, so I don't have an opinion on that being crap. I have... I have not really had too much time with Dendro and other elements. I know that like Dendro and Pyro and Dendro and Electro do some pretty awesome stuff, but, or maybe it's Dendro and Hydro, or maybe all three, I'm not really sure. And from what I've seen, it doesn't look like Dendro and Cryo do anything, do they? Maybe they do, and I just haven't noticed, but every time I use Dendro, or use Cryo whenever Dendro is nearby, I never seem to do, like, anything extra to the enemy. But maybe it's like a status effect, like, oh, the enemy has slower attack or something, I don't know. And I just don't notice it. So unfortunately, I can't really break down this question any further because I don't know enough about Dendro yet, nor do I really mess around with the elemental reactions outside of just, oh shit, that did big PP damage, let me do more of that. Oh, that stuff's good. Okay, so the next question is, it's like flavored water. Next question is, you've probably talked about this before, but I forgore, so oh well. What's your opinion on the quick start option for events, being able to skip some useless or important quests? I think it's fantastic, but there's a huge fucking glaring issue with it. As I've shown off during the Grave and Innocence coverage, the Sumeru event. First of all, it's awesome because it means that people don't have to be locked out of doing limited time content just because they are so far behind in the story. You know, I've made it clear before that I did not like the idea of blasting through the main story just to get an event done before its time is up, right? I never liked that idea because it ruins the pace of how I like to enjoy my games. And so the quick start event gives me the option to say, oh, this event needs you to have this Archon story done, but I'm way the hell back here on the Archon story, but I can click quick start, skip all that, and be able to start it, just with the caveat that maybe I don't recognize some of the characters or don't understand some of the context, you know, but at least I'm getting the event done within the allotted amount of time and not blasting through a story to get there. But of course, despite loving the idea, it is almost entirely useless depending on where you are in the Archon story, as was shown during the Grave and Innocence, where I used Quick Start to skip the Sumeru Archon story, but it even says that some characters might be busy on other quests, which then, again, makes me ask, what the fuck's the point, then, with that stupid system? But after using it to Quick Start, I started that event, started talking to the NPC that gives you the event, and then the moment the event actually was given to me, like I was officially starting it, it immediately locked me out because Kale was busy with the Archon story. Well, then what the fuck's the point in quick starting if that shit is still gonna happen? And then, if you'll remember, I went and talked to Kale, I started the Archon story until we got to Kale, we started Kale's stuff, and then bam, I was able to continue the event. So I went back to the event, and then did like two lines of dialogue, and then suddenly Kale was busy again, which made no sense because she hadn't moved anywhere from where she just was. It didn't make any fucking sense to me. And then it happened again, which was very, very frustrating to me. So on one hand, I think Quick Start is an amazing feature and I love it to death. But on the other hand, it's almost useless in and of itself because it does that shit, right? So if HoYoverse wants to make Quick Start work, they need to fix that crap because it makes no sense to have Quick Start if you're still going to be locked out of events because you have an Archon story that needs to be done because a character is busy on that story quest, right? Now, I was told that if I hadn't finished the Chasm story, I wouldn't have had those interruptions because it only happened because the Sumeru Archon story was available to me. But then again, that still begs the same question. Why the fuck does it happen in the first place? It's supposed to quick start, skip those quests, not make people busy on them anyways. So that's where I stand on that feature. Hopefully they work on refining that down the road. But overall, I'm very happy with the idea that now people that have just started playing the game, you know, last week, don't have to worry about an event that will take them, you know, 50 hours to get to by playing through tons of story and needing to do lots and lots of exploration to get that far just to unlock the event story, right? Because it's not really fair to newer players to be blocked out on newer content, newer events, and limited time events just because they aren't far enough in the story yet. You know what I mean? So, but okay. So question number 3 is, are you interested in HoYoverse's upcoming game, ZZZ, or Zenless Zone Zero, which I have never heard of, so I cannot answer that part of the question, and could you see yourself doing an LP on it? Maybe with one, or excuse me, or maybe with one of their older games, like Honkai Impact the Third. So we've already talked about my Honkai Impact, that I would actually be interested in doing an LP on it, I just probably wouldn't dedicate as much time or resources to it as I do to Genshin. I would at least play it for the story. But this Triple Z I've never heard of until just now, so I'm actually going to look it up. Zenless Zone Zero. Let's see what this is. I see... Okay, so it's an upcoming urban fantasy action role-playing game developed and published by HoYoverse. Okay, that sounds kind of interesting. I'm opening up their website right now to get a better look at it. There's a car. What the hell? That's so weird just to see cars with this, but... I can already say that I'm not too big a fan of the direction of their or outfit styles. I don't really roll that way, but maybe I'd have to see more... I'd have to read in more about it to know, like, what the setting really is. Like, if I click on characters, is that... Oh god, there's music playing. Holy shit, that scared the fuck out of me. Oh shit. I mean, yeah, I had not heard a single thing about this until just now. Okay, let's see. So, characters. I mean, there's a bear. That's kind of cool that there's animals, playable animal characters. There's like different factions. Man, I don't know shit about what I'm looking at right now. News and info? I don't know. How do I find out, like, a summary of what the game is about? Is it in background? Let's see. No. What the hell? VHS tapes? Homepage? It doesn't tell me shit, man. I can just sign up for it if I want to. I don't know. I guess I'll have to look deeper into it later. I mean, it just gives me, like the take on commit- oh god, take on commissions. And traverse between hollows. What's a hollow? Changing labyrinths. Discover various factions and uncover a conspiracy. Now that sounds fun. I like the idea of that. Last Metropolis. I don't know, it's like an apocalyptic future. Live dual identities, two opposing personas. I don't know, I'd have to keep an eye on it. Right now, just based off of, like, I don't want to be that guy that judges stuff on the surface, but just based purely off of the sign-up screen, I'm not interested. I don't like that style of clothing. But if I see some gameplay, then perhaps I'll be interested in kind of popping back in and maybe giving it a try. Especially if it's free, like Genshin was, then it's one of those cases where it's like, well, it doesn't really hurt to at least give it a try and see what it's like. But moving on to your fourth question, your favorite quest or story moment in Genshin so far, it's the fight with the big multi-headed sea creature in the Liyue quest. Well, that and probably when Signora is executed. Those are probably my two favorite moments in the story of Genshin so far, and I'll kind of explain why. Well, I already explained with the Raiden Shogun, because it's a very dark moment in the story, but also because the Shogun is just... bad fucking ass. She's so ridiculous. Like, her puppet or whatever is so fucking badass. the way that she just walks down the stairs with her sword drawn, cold stare, stern and firm. She walks straight past the traveler and just, it completely ignores everything that Signora is screeching out about being a diplomat and all that. Nope, she's dead. I loved that whole scene. And then the music that plays is, oh, chef's kiss. But the battle in Liyue against the Mr. Sea creature was probably the most large scale event, because it felt more like there was more people involved, you know? I mean, sure, we had a fight in Inazuma between the two armies that were fighting. That was really cool too. And that's kind of like what I'm talking about, but it wasn't as grand scale. You see the fight with the what the fuck was that thing's name? Let me look that up. Genshin Impact. I'm trying to. Oh, fuck that name. Okay, whatever. We'll just call it the sea creature right now. The thing that I liked about it was it didn't just feel like, oh my god, everything, you know, it wasn't just traveler on opponent as the, you know, the verses. You had the traveler, you had the adeptus, you had other characters, you had Kei Ching was there, everyone was running forward and getting into the fight. You had these magical like ballistas that were being used as weapons. You had the Fatui charging through. You had this massive sea creature that was just outside a city full of hundreds of innocent people. You had this gorgeous music that was playing that was super suspenseful and kept everything tense. You were on the edge of your seat the whole time. It was just a spectacle that was more than just the traveler. It was something the traveler was involved in, not something that was revolving around the traveler, you know what I mean? That's why I think that's probably the most epic moment in the story so far, because it was just more than just you, basically. And I would love to see more stuff like that moving forward, because it was awesome. And we got we kind of got that too with the interlude chapter where the wife of the sea creature or whatever came to attack as well, and again, multiple people were involved in fighting back against it. It wasn't just the traveler. So that's probably my favorite moment in the Genshin story so far, along with the Raiden Shogun's execution scene. Number five on the question list is, this is less of a question, more of a reminder. Books in Genshin, reading them, yeah? Character voices, traveler's unique voice dialogues with Paimon, read them at some point. Yes, this is something that I've gotten told a lot, and it's something that I do want to do at some point. I just don't know when. But when I do them, it'll probably be its own dedicated episode. That way, if they're easier to find. Like, I think if I ever listen to, like, all of the voice lines from a character, I will do all of their voice lines in one video, right? And then that whole video will be dedicated to their voices. The problem with the voice lines is, to get them all, you have to grind the character's friendship up to level 10, and it just takes 10 years to get up to 10, as we've seen, where I've put so much fragile resin into grinding just friendship levels, and, you know, that kind of holds it back a little bit, but the traveler's unique voice dialogues, I guess we can probably look at that kind of stuff too. In books, of course, I've got shitloads of books that I pretty much never read any of them, and I'm sure that this is where you can get a lot of that extra information on the lore or other mysteries and stories with the world. But yeah, I never forget about the books, and someday I will get around to doing that in some form. I don't know how I will do the books, because I can't really read out loud very well, so reading those would be a nightmare to listen to. Okay, so let's move on to the next question, which is actually that same person's second set of questions, which is now, holy shit, 10 questions, and these are longer questions as well, so let's see. Round 2 for me, I guess. Question number 1. Do you think Genshin would benefit from having more grindable content? So like removing the resin limit so that you can just infinitely farm artifacts, for example. Or do you think it's good that you can't spend all of your time on Genshin every single day? I assume there are benefits to both, but what's your take on this? Material grinding is a thing already, going around killing enemies to get their items, like slime condensates, or hilichurl arrowheads, but I don't really ever see anyone do that kind of grinding. Well, first of all, you can spend all your time in a day on Genshin, even if you're out of resin. There's still other stuff that you can do that doesn't require resin, and even though the other stuff has refresh timers, like killing enemies, you have to wait a day, or you know, collecting certain materials, you have to wait 3 days. But I think it would probably refresh before you get through and kill every enemy that's in the entire world so far. But is regarding resin usage, it's an interesting question because I don't care about people that don't want to spend their whole day on Genshin, because there are people that do, you know? And it's my belief that I cannot stand being limited in what I'm allowed to do at any given time. So when Genshin limits how much I can do at a single time, it is pretty infuriating. And it's very inconvenient, especially for people that have, like, jobs or school or both. Because it's not a game that's requiring you to put in, you know, a day's worth of work. But when you can only put so much work in to a certain game, and then they limit how much you can do in a single day, well, what if I only have, you know, enough time this weekend to get stuff done? Well, now I'm kind of fucked because I only have so much resin to use during the weekend, or I only have so much that I can pick up during the 3 day period or the 2 day period I'm online, and then for the rest of the week I'm going to be so busy I won't get a chance to play anything. And it just sucks to be limited in regards to that, because then you do end up getting bit in the ass because you have a limited amount of resin to use. Personally, I do not like having a limitation based on resin. Of course, I would not like to spend my whole day farming artifacts, because I don't find that fun, but I do think it would benefit from more content, more grindable content, like similar to like fishing, for example, right? Because that's something you can grind, and it's like a little mini game. So more stuff like that scattered around the world, I think, would be really fun and enjoyable to mess around with. But yeah, just to reiterate, I don't like being limited, so I think the game would benefit from not having a resin limit, or at least increasing the resin limit from 160 and up, because it can be very, you can only fight like a few bosses in a day, and it takes 8 minutes to regenerate. So either you could say raise the resin limit or lower the amount of time it takes to refresh one resin, because it's 8 minutes per one resin, right? Which is like a pain in the ass sometimes to wait for. But moving on, question number two is, besides blue cream soda, or whatever it was, I forgot, what other drinks are something you often buy? Doesn't need to be a special drink you only buy on big occasions, but something you buy semi-daily from stores. Well, I don't buy anything semi-daily anymore, but I will still humor your question as if I did. So, yes, blue cream soda is, you did remember correctly, and that is a special drink because I can't get it very often. It's blue cream soda is a, it's a cream soda that has like a blueberry or blue raspberry flavor to it, very faint, and they're sold in glass bottles, and they only sell them at certain stores around here, and so I don't get them very often. They're of course very expensive. I think the last time I really had a huge supply of these, I bought 20 of these. I bought their whole stock from this store. Last year when Higurashi was releasing, because I wanted to have a whole bunch of drinks for Higurashi Sotsu, the final season. So I stocked up on those, and then they all went by in like a day. No, I didn't drink them that fast, but at least 2 days. But drinks I buy on like semi-often, of course, chocolate milk. I love chocolate milk. It's like the nectar of the gods. I don't think there's a better drink out there than chocolate milk. Only if you get the right chocolate milk. I'm speaking best non-carbonated drink here, because of course, depending on brand, depending on the mixture, and depending on the flavor, it can completely change how I feel about the chocolate milk. I do not like low-fat chocolate milks, for example. They're like watered-down milky syrup, and it's just nasty in my opinion. So I prefer a fattier milk for chocolate milk, a nice thick and creamy chocolate milk. But other drinks are usually juice. I like juice, so I'll drink just about any kind of juice, like fruit juice. I'll drink apple juice, grape juice, strawberry, kiwi. I'll drink it's easier to say what juices I won't drink. I don't drink orange juice. I don't like orange juice. I won't drink just straight cranberry juice, but I'll drink cranberry with something, so like cranberry grape, for example. I'll drink that. But as far as sodas are concerned, you know, not assuming that I'm just drinking water, but sodas, which I like to have when I do Let's Plays and stuff, I will drink various, pretty much again, I'll drink just about any kind of soda, but the ones I drink most often are my favorite one is Vanilla Coke. I am a Coke product fan. I'm not really a fan of the Pepsi product, but I will drink Pepsi if it's the only option. Then of course, Coke. I'll also drink various types of root beer here in where I live. We drink a lot of A&W root beer. It's very American. And then of course we've got Dr. Pepper I will drink frequently. And then there's usually like a crush flavor, which is usually orange or like strawberry or something that I'll end up drinking at some point every now and then. So those are usually what I like drinking when I do things like Let's Plays or I spend time with somebody and I'm playing a game with them or watching something with them. I usually have a drink like that. And then I'll drink water myself any other time. Whenever I eat meals, I always drink water and occasionally milk I'll have with meals. But I don't like drinking soda with meals. I don't like drinking juice with meals. Anything that really is flavored heavily, I don't drink with meals. But that's a story for another time. But yeah, those are the drinks that I most often buy. Like right now, I'm drinking a cherry water, cherry flavored water. I don't like flavored water, but this is like a sugary drink, I guess. I don't know really how to explain it. I guess it's comparable to Kool-Aid, basically, is what I'm having right now. But it's cherry flavor, which is actually pretty good because I'm not too big on cherry usually. So question number 3 is, how do you feel? Or excuse me, how does it feel that your Genshin LP alone has more content than the entirety of One Piece? Episode amount-wise, you have less, but most of your episodes are easily longer than an average One Piece episode, lol. Well, that's an interesting question. I've never seen One Piece or read One Piece, but I know it's kind of like the running gag that it's a fucking series that doesn't. It has like 900 episodes or something, and it's just still going and going and going. It has been going for like 2 decades now. How does it feel? I don't know. Feels pretty good, I guess. I don't know anything about One Piece, so I can't say whether I'm happy to have more than it or less than it. But it's, I mean, since someone else had already mentioned One Piece in their questions, which I think it's kind of funny that people are talking about that. But question number 4 is, with the introduction of 2 relatively new characters, Candace and Hazo, which I think is the character we missed, right? We now have more unique takes on the already existing character classes. Hazo uses a catalyst, but instead of standing back like a mage, he empowers his fists and feet to strike, basically making him a monk class. Oh, right, I noticed this during one of the one of those events. I think it was the I think it was the Fize Trials event or whatever. It was one of those where they forced you to use trial characters when you were taking the pictures, and I remember just noticing a character that was punching and kicking. And I think that was him. I guess that must be who you're talking about, which is pretty interesting, actually. But anyways, continuing on. Candace uses a polearm, but her real gameplay is all about her shield, making her more of a defending or shield bashing character more than anything else. So my question is, if HoYoverse doesn't want to introduce new classes besides Sword, Polearm, Catalyst, Claymore, and Bow, do you have any other cool ideas or takes on how to make new characters stay within those classes while being very unique, like Hazo or Candace? Anything you'd like to see in particular? I think I remember you mentioning guns at one point. Yeah, actually, I would love to see a character with a gun, or guns in general. We already know that there are guns in Genshin. We have the that Fatui flame rifle guy that uses the fire rifle. So there are some sort of projectile gun-like weapons. Even if they're not technically guns, they are gun-like. And of course, we've got heavy artillery and cannons and stuff. So it's definitely a possibility to be able to see weapons like that. And since we're not introducing new weapon types and we're sticking with sword, polearm, catalyst, claymore, and bow, a gun could be someone's burst. Or someone's skill, for example, where you hold E down to pull out a gun and then aim it, right? Or your burst is to pull out a gun and then use sort of a ranged attack that maybe you aim just like a bow user aims, but you do huge damage or it's super accurate or whatever. It has some sort of special ability with it. I think that they could work that in. But the character's weapon could be, well, I'm trying to think of what would work best with a gun user. I mean, you might say a bow, but then you have ranged with a ranged ability. I think it would make sense to have a close light range, like maybe a sword, user have a gun on his back or her back, and then you're able to pull it out for a ranged attack that maybe, I don't know, debuffs the enemy or buffs the enemy, or yeah, hopefully we have a skill that buffs the enemy. No, but maybe debuffs the enemy or buffs your damage against them or something. That would be really cool. I've also wanted to see axes in the game in some form. I think there probably is a character that uses an axe, but I'm talking more like battle axes or whatever. Maybe their burst is equipping dual battle axes and then just going ham on the enemy. I don't know, right? I'm just trying to think of other weapon types that we don't have playable that we could see in whatever form. But I think, yeah, as far as the gun goes, I think you could make a gun work as a skill or a burst on a character, just like we have other characters that equip or utilize different weapon types with their skills or bursts. So number 5 is, would you like to see inhuman or monstrous characters as playable ones? Yes. Abso-fucking-lutely. I would love to see, like, badass... You know, Razor? I would play the shit out of Razor if he was an actual wolf. that would be bad fucking ass to see that kind of stuff. Now, if we're talking, like, monstrous, so inhuman, I'm thinking, like, you know, a cat girl, but she's actually a cat. If you're talking monstrous, I'm thinking, like, Hillichurl-type creatures, which I would also like to play. Exactly how they would implement that, I don't know, but I guess it could be, like, any other playable character. They would have their own voice, their own personality, and a weapon type. They would just not look like a human, right? Just a creature with human-like features. So yeah, I would absolutely like to see that type of thing in the game. Chances are when you ask me, would you like to see this in this game? If it's a game I like, I want to see everything. I will never pretty much say no, I don't want to see that, unless it's a feature that I specifically think would be a downgrade to something or the experience. So question number 6 is, what new miscellaneous gameplay mechanics would you like to see added in the game, like fishing, cooking, the teapot system, and decorating your home? I do want to see more stuff like that, because it's really fun to do a lot of those, like the fishing, and even cooking is really fun, and the teapot system you can spend a lot of time on. It's just trying to figure out what is difficult. Like, just right off the top of my head, it's difficult to come up with any of those, like, ideas that I would have for miscellaneous type of scenario of activities. I would love to see the rhythm game feature from some events in the past come back. There, I think, have been 3 different rhythm game events, and I missed one of them, but I did play the other 2, and they were really fun. If they could bring that in as like an actual activity that you can play every day or something, that would be a lot of fun to do. And maybe like the different music tracks you unlock, you can then play. Like the spin crystals you unlock, I think, for your housing. If we could have something like that, where as you collect music around the world, you can then play a mini game tied to that rhythm, or a mini like rhythm game tied to that track. That would be a lot of fun. But they go on to say, question 6.1, which is, are you still interested in concentrating on the teapot? You are gathering wood, and that can only be used in the teapot, or maybe one daily quest, lol. So are we getting some teapot decoration love anytime soon? That is exactly why I'm doing the woodcutting episode, because I wanted to work on my housing again. I've been wanting to work on it for a long time, but I kind of stopped when I realized that Inazuma has its own region, or its own realm, and I wanted to get it, but in order to get it, I had to unlock it, and in order to unlock it, I had to grind Inazuma, so that's what I spent a lot of time doing last week, and now that I have access to it, well, it's woodcutting episode time, because baby, we're gonna be working the shit out of that house. Although, I can complain that, again, I hate being limited, and the housing system has very limited amounts of stuff you can do in each room, which sucks, but whatever. Right now, I'm just excited to work on that again. Okay, so question number 7 is, Genshin has a lot of dialogue in the quests, like a lot. What's your opinion on it? Do you think there's too much, the right amount, or too little? Is it interesting dialogue, or do you think some of it is meaningless fluff filler dialogue? And question 7.1, would you like a skip button or an exit button conversation, an exit conversation button in Genshin? Well, first of all, the amount of dialogue in Genshin so far in the quest, of course I haven't done every world quest, but the amount of dialogue that has been in quests that I've done has never fazed me, because although you say that it has a lot of dialogue, to me, this game does not have a lot of dialogue. Compared to even smaller RPGs out there that have hours upon hours upon hours of dialogue in just certain sections of the game. Genshin Impact is small fry compared to that dialogue-wise. But do I think that the dialogue is, like when you say, do I think there's too much of it? It's not that I think there's too much. It's just that I think sometimes it can be a little bit annoying when, like, you're talking to an NPC or a character, and then that character says in a sentence, they're like, okay, well, you know, I should let you go. Or, you know, or go work on that, or I'm going to head off to do this, or whatever, you know, whatever. It's they say something that's, like, going to end the conversation, right? And then you click, and then they have another thing to say. And then you click, and then they have another thing to say. And then you click, and then they have another thing to say. And then you click, and then they have another thing to say. And then you click, and then finally the conversation ends. That can be a little frustrating sometimes. But what makes it the most frustrating is exactly what you ask with question 7.1. There is no skip or exit conversation button. And it's really annoying because take a game like The Witcher 3, for example, right? Or even Mass Effect. In games like The Witcher 3, you have dialogue options. Let's say you have 5 dialogue options. Let's say 2 of them are gold and 3 of them are gray colored, right? The golden ones will progress the conversation forward, but the gray ones ask miscellaneous information that will not progress the conversation. It will instead branch the conversation off to the side. So I can ask, and when I ask I use one of the gray options, that you'll go through that part of the conversation, and then it will double back to the 5 options again, except now one of the gray ones is grayed out. So I can ask the other gray ones and continue, and then once I'm done asking those to get all the additional information, I can just continue right on with one of the gold options and finish the conversation. But it always takes me back. Mass Effect is the same way. There are dialogue options that you can ask for just additional information, and then it will immediately snap you back to be able to ask to continue the conversation, you know, and end the conversation. In Genshin, unfortunately, there are multiple conversations where there are, you know, various dialogue options that some will even lead you to getting, you know, rewards. But what about the other options? Let's say there was 2 dialogue options and I pick option 1 and then progress through the conversation that way, and then the conversation ends. I don't get to go back and pick the other option. I have to then open the chat again with them and then sit there through the conversation again and pick the right dialogue options to catch up to that point. And I have to spam click to skip through the stuff I've already seen. There's no other skip option. And it's also annoying too, because if you accidentally talk to an NPC when you're trying to interact with something else, you cannot exit the conversation until you spam click through it and end it through a conversation option. A dialogue option. There is no, like, I can't press escape and just leave the conversation, which is pretty annoying, especially when there's, like, a restaurant notice board nearby and you accidentally click that when you're trying to open a door or you're, like, trying to interact with, like, the cooking pot in Inazuma. It's right next to that sign that says something about drinks, and you always freaking click that drink sign every time I try to interact with the cooking pot, or when I try to go into the bar in Mondstadt and I always click on the notice board instead because it's like the first thing that comes up. You have to sit there and wait through the dialogue and spam click through it. You can't just exit it, which is really annoying. So overall, yes, I fucking want a skip or exit conversation button, please. As for the rest of it, I kind of answered. I don't really know if there's anything else you can change about that, but I would like to be able to just pick a dialogue option that doesn't progress the conversation, but is just asking additional information that then takes me back to the multiple dialogue choice automatically, so that I don't have to sit through the whole beginning of the conversation again each time just to pick the other dialogue options, which can be a little bit tedious to do. But okay, so question number 8 is, I recently had a discussion with Lar on Discord about collection elements in the game. He said that if he had an abundant amount of extra resources, he would still not fully try to build or pull for characters he is less interested in. I am very much the opposite, and my goal is to get every character and get them to level 90 with max talents eventually. Where do you fall on this spectrum? Are you a completionist in this sense, or are there some characters you really feel meh about building even if you have the extra resources? So I consider myself a completionist and a perfectionist in games. That's why I love playing games that have collectibles or collectathon type of things, or games with skills and XP where you can max characters out. That is something that I really enjoy. So for me, even if it's a character that I'm not interested in, yeah, my long-term goal is to collect every character, is to max out every character's level and talents, as you say. Unfortunately, it's hard to max out character stats because you need artifacts for that. But at least as far as the permanent stuff is concerned, so their ascension levels, their weapons and weapon levels, and their talents are things that I do want to max out, because those you can max out, period. And once they're maxed out, they're done. There's no RNG involved like there is with artifact grinding. The same does apply to weapons. I want to get every weapon. That's why I have one of every weapon. I want to get the weapons to full refinement. I want to get them fully ascended. At least one of each. I don't need to have a collection of, you know, 8 5-star weapons, all refinement 5 with, you know, level 90 on them. But that's where I stand on that, because it's a sort of a progression thing. It's the idea of collecting stuff, and the abundance of resources, they're there to be used for collecting. They're there to be collected to then be used on characters. And I would like to play with every character, even ones I'm not interested in, someday. Just to get some use out of every character and feature every character in some way in the series. But yeah, and like just recently, just now, I have my very first party that all four characters are level 90, which I've never had a full party of level 90s before, to the best of my knowledge. So I've taken multiple characters up to level 90 and multiple weapons up to level 90 in just the past couple weeks alone, compared to how long I've been playing the game. But moving on to question number 9, I know you've talked about event permanency before, but what is your opinion on the amount of new content Genshin pushes out? There's one major event every patch, there are a bunch of small events, and nowadays it feels like whenever you log on, there's always some event going on. I assume this is a good thing in most people's eyes, but do you have anything to say about the amount of content released, or are you just satisfied with how much we get? It doesn't matter. I don't mean to sound too harsh, but it literally doesn't fucking matter how much event content they push out at a single time, because it's not permanent. So if I log on today, yeah, let's say I'm logging on for the first time. Sure, yeah, there's event content there, and I'm like, ooh, wow, lots of content. What about the fucking, you know, 20, 30, 40, 50, 60 plus events that I've missed, because they're not around anymore? So it doesn't matter how often they push events out. It's still going to be fucking someone over somewhere who can't play the event or hasn't even played the game yet for the first time and doesn't even get a chance to get any of the content that might be unique to those events when they log in for the first time, if they, you know, decide to become interested in Genshin Impact. I will never in my life ever support exclusivity in a game. Ever. And events are exclusivity, because you have events that last a limited time with exclusive content. And of course, sometimes it's story quests with dialogue that's important. Sometimes it's unique weapons or unique items, unique furnishings, etc., that are only found in those events. And if you miss the event, you're fucked. For the most part. Apparently, sometimes like the event items, like the musical instruments, become available through other shops. And, like, of course, sometimes outfits for characters, they make those available in the shop, for example, to purchase with real money, which, again, is perfectly okay. I'm okay with that. And I'm just so happy that characters do not work this way. If characters were limited time, like from the event banner, and then once you miss them, you could never get them again. They would never rerun or never get put in the standard banner or something. I would not be able to play Genshin for very long without being able to sustain that part of the experience, you know? So, to kind of answer your question, yes, I've talked about permanency before, and my opinion on amount of new content, I do not give a shit how much new content Genshin has if it's event content. Permanent content and how much they push out there, they push out huge regions with lots to do in it, I'm very happy about that. The event content, yes, some of the events can be really fun to play. I totally agree, right? And it's fun to just get primogems and stuff, but the problem is it's limited time, so it doesn't matter how much they push out, because you have to already be an active player to make use of that. I just have to say that, thank Christ, right now, Genshin does not require you to have 3 lives to actually do an event. Because if it did, then I'd have a serious problem. But thankfully, its events are not requiring you to have 3 extra lives to spend on it. And can be finished in relative ease with not too much time put in just a single day of work. and by single day, I don't mean 24 hours, I mean just a few hours in a single day can get you finished with even bigger events. So that's where I stand on that. But moving on to question number 10, are there any quality of life, or QOL, updates you'd like to see added in Genshin? Oh boy, yes, there's a few quality of life, or things that I would consider quality of life changes. The first thing is make artifact grinding more bearable. You know, I mean, it's ridiculous how you are never guaranteed shit when artifact grinding, and that it requires resin to grind, which means you can only do it so much at a single time without using fragile resin, and you only have so much fragile resin at a single time. Make it something like the character banners, where you are guaranteed some type of artifact at some point after grinding it enough. So sure, you have to spend time grinding it, and you know, it's total RNG during that, but then let's say after you get so many domain completions or so many artifacts earned, you are guaranteed to get an artifact, and then you pick like what set you want it to be for, or maybe it's tied to that domain specifically, and then you get to choose, you know, what stat you want on it. Maybe you can't choose the substats, but you can at least choose the primary stat, because sometimes, like has been explained to me with goblets, it's fucking ridiculous how lucky you have to be to fight the RNG just to get the right goblet. And that's one of five fucking pieces. Not only do you have to hope you get the right primary stat, but then you have to pray that the substats are accurate. And then when you actually level up the artifact, you have to fucking pray that it's gonna beef up the substats you want it to beef up, and not pick, like, you know, some other fucking shit that you don't need, really, right? And because it is purely random, there's, like, no variation, you could literally... Like, this is why I say when you're leveling a character and ascending them, or you're grinding their materials for their weapon, you know, or grinding their talents, it's always permanent, because it'll take a long time to get everything maxed out on a character, and it'll take a lot of resources, but at least it's permanent. Every one resource you collect for their ascension material is one less you're going to need overall, right? And you're always guaranteed to max them out as long as you put in the grinding effort. But with artifacts, you could grind a domain literally 100 times and get 200 artifacts out of it of the same set and never be guaranteed to get even the right one for just one piece, right? That's how it works, and it sucks, and it's the least favorite part of the game for me. Equipping artifacts and, you know, trying to mix and match artifacts, that can be fun, but actually grinding them is not fun at all, just because it's too RNG focused. There's not anything else there. I need to have something there. If I was only able to do artifact grind, if this was like Final Fantasy 14 where endgame content was just raids and dungeons, I would not be able to enjoy Genshin Impact if all of the game was just grind artifacts as endgame. I would burn out so fast, which is probably why I'm kind of scared to finish the game, you know, where I'm at right now and 100% everything, but I'm trying to make do with what I've got. Well, let me think about some other quality of life changes. What else would I like to see in Genshin Impact, quality of life? Honestly, I think that's the biggest... I mean, artifact grinding is genuinely the largest and pretty much only issue I have with Genshin's gameplay. Of course, there might be annoyances I have with other aspects of the game too. And of course, I don't like the event situation, but that's not tied directly to the game's mechanics itself. It would be... It would be the lack of guarantee in artifact grinding. And I would like to see something similar updated with the weapon banner. The weapon banner more so, because it is so ridiculous to me how the weapon banner is just egregious. But the character banner is so much better. And even then, the character banner still costs you a shitload. But getting a full character, when there's two event weapons every time they do a banner, and then you've got a collection of event 4-star weapons and everything, yet... You have to get the 5-star 3 times just to be guaranteed to get the event weapon you chose, assuming you didn't get it the first 2 times, is ridiculous. Because that's not how it works with the characters. I don't know why they do it that way. It's really ridiculous. Honestly, the quality of life change I would make to the weapon banner is carry over progress. Why does progress carry over, like pity progress, why does that carry over on the weapon, or excuse me, on the event banner for character and the standard banner, but it doesn't for the weapon banner? It would make total sense for the weapon banner to be the one that actually carries over progress the most. If they could change that where it carries over progress, then man, I would actually put pulls into the weapon banner when I don't have money. I mean, I've spent literally up to $400 just to make sure I'm getting the right stuff on character and weapon banners before. Remember the Dark Age weapon banner pull? Yeah, that's how much the weapon banner sucks. And there's usually always, even if the weapons are really good on a certain character, there's usually always alternatives that you can pick. So it doesn't make any sense to me why the weapon banner is so expensive and just lacking in allowing you to, I don't know, have more. I don't know, whatever. It is what it is, I guess, but I would personally like to see some changes made there where maybe pull pity progress carries over to the next weapon banner that's available. Okay, but that's all of those questions. So let me see, what have we got left? So we actually don't have much left here to look at. We've got, let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4 questions left, or 4 different people's questions left. And they're mostly smaller questions, or, well, one of them is asking questions that I think is going to probably add a little bit of extra time on. So I guess this episode's probably going to be about 3 hours long, and hopefully I'll be able to pump it out, because I'm worried that it's going to, like, not want to render properly, but we'll see how it goes. Okay, so I will start with the smallest question first, which is from Ice, who says, what are your thoughts on the upcoming Genshin anime? Do you want the story to be about things we've done in the game, for example, Mondstadt Archon Quest, or events that occurred before the game, like the Archon War? Well, I don't know if it's going to focus on, like, the Archon War. The concept trailer shows both the brother and sister together, so that would make sense. It would make sense that we're following the Traveler's story. But they're asking specifically, what would I like to see? And honestly, man, okay, this is difficult, because on one hand, I would love to see an anime version of what we have seen in the game, because the reason I love that kind of thing is because then you could watch one or play one and then swap. So if I play Genshin, I can then watch the anime and then see all these events I played in the game on an anime, or I can watch the anime and then play the game and play the events that I watched in the anime, you know? So you get that really big level of excitement of being able to swap back and forth. But of course, that's only if they do a good job at recreating the events from the game. Because if they don't do a good job on that, well, then you're fucked. You know, because then you have a really sour experience of playing the game and being blown away by, you know, the fight with Storm Terror, and then watching the anime, and it's like... So I do like that aspect, but there is a risk there. Then, of course, we've got, what if it tells its own story? You know, not one that we see in the game, but not one that's a prequel or a sequel, just its own journey, but still following the same kind of beats as the game does. I think that's acceptable too. I'm just not too big of a fan of that, when we're taking something from the source and then changing it. I've never been a fan of that type of thing, but it's an option. What I want to see most is a recreation of the events we've already experienced in the game. That's what I want the most. But of course, I wouldn't complain about seeing a prequel about the Archon War. Of course, I would still love to see that shit, too. But either way, we'll have to wait and see when we get closer to its release and see some other trailers. Because if it opens up a trailer and you hear the characters talking about shit that happened in the game, and then you see clips of stuff from the game, then of course, chances are... I mean, can you imagine seeing the Raiden Shogun in anime form? Think about it. Okay, so moving on, the next set of questions is from Destiny, who asks 4 different questions. So the first question is, what's your favorite villain in Genshin Impact? Now the second question specifically asks, who is your favorite Archon? Now this is difficult, because when you consider a villain, are we just talking like people who are pure evil, or are we just talking like antagonists, or people who are portrayed as antagonists? Because it's going to get a bit redundant, but if I had to pick my favorite antagonist, it would be the Raiden Shogun, again. Because she is just badass in every single possible way. The way she's designed, the way she controls everything, the way she believes in eternity, the way her entire country is basically depressed as fuck because of her decisions, etc., right? But then at the same time, my favorite Archon, well, we've got Venti, we've got Zhongli, we've got the Raiden Shogun, and now we have Kusanali. And my favorite one would be the Raiden Shogun again, because, again, just everything about her design and her character and how badass she is. By the way, I was thinking the other day, I was thinking about Kusanali. I was like, okay, so she's a female Archon. What the fuck? We've got three of the four Archons that have been shown off so far have been females. The only male one is Zhong Li. And I kept thinking, I'm like, right? Zhong Li's the only guy of the Archons so far. And I'm almost positive that we're going to get more female Archons down the road. But then I'm like, wait a minute, Venti's a guy. I literally genuinely forgot again. I was like, oh yeah, the Mondstadt's a female, Inazuma's a female, you know, and for whatever reason, I just totally forgot about Venti again. But yeah, that would have to answer question one and two. If we want to consider the Raiden Shogun as a villain, as an antagonist, then that's who I would choose for question one. I don't really think there's anyone else, any other villain, that I have liked more than her story so far, or her part in the Archon story. Question number three is least favorite boss or enemy to fight. Now, when you ask least favorite, I'm going to assume you're asking what one I hate the most. Because technically, when you ask least favorite, you're talking about a boss that I still like to fight. I just like to fight less than the other bosses. But I'm going to assume that you are asking about my most hated boss, the one I just don't like to fight at all, which is a little bit difficult when you consider that most of the bosses in Genshin are actually pretty good. Or are like they're made pretty well, and they have, you know, distinct patterns of attack. The Trounce domain bosses can rape you in 2 seconds if you're not ready for it. But I don't think there's really any that I hate too much. And of course, there are still bosses I have never fought in Genshin too. So keep that in mind. I guess if I had to pick one that I'm not too big a fan of, just compared to the rest, it would be those, what are they called? It's the ones that I had to grind for Yaimiko's stuff in Enkanomiya. Let me see, Genshin. The Bathysmal Vishap Herd, where you have to fight the two big Vishap creatures. I'm not too big on that one. But your fourth question is favorite event and storyline so far. Well, my favorite event, I think we kind of established, was probably one of the Lantern Rite events. And my favorite storyline, as far as like the Archon story is concerned, it's a close call between Inazuma and Sumeru. And then they finish off by saying, really bad at thinking of questions, but here you go, lol. No worry, those were some fine questions. Okay, so there are two questions left, two people left with a collection of questions. One has posted 9 and the other has posted 6. So I will start with Hachikuji, who starts off by asking, are you planning to change the Genshin voiceover language anytime soon? If so, what language will it be? Something dies inside me every time I listen to English Paimon. That's awesome. I love it. Me too, man. Me too. So we already talked about the whole language thing, that it's possible I might change it soon, and if I do, it'll probably be Chinese, if not Japanese, going back to that. Or if people want me to do Korean, I will try that out, since we've never tried it yet. But yes, I don't want to sit here and spend 40 minutes complaining about it, but after getting to play with the English voice actors for a solid period of time and getting to hear them through the Chasm and the Sumeru Archon story so far, I do have to say that I think for the most part, a lot of them get the job done just fine. There are only a few that I don't like, and or really despise. I've talked about I do not like Venti's English voice actor. And of course, the one that just is so mind-numbing to me is Paimon. Although we've heard her old English voice, which was not great, but much better than it is now, yet we have to deal with what we've got now all the fucking time. And when I have to hear her, because she talks pretty much all the time, she does the talking with the Traveler, and she usually does the talking for the Traveler. So you have to hear her non-stop in Archon quests, or story quests, or event quests. It's always Paimon that will be talking at for most of it, right? And yes, something dies inside me. I mean, she will genuinely hurt my ears. When she talks for too long, my ears will start ringing. Almost like the sound you get, you know, when you take like a wine glass and you move your finger atop of it. You know, when it makes that noise and it kind of pierces through your brain. That's the sound I will get in my ears, both of them. And I'll have to turn my headset audio down whenever she's talking, and I will still feel that pain until she shuts the fuck up, right? And it's worse whenever she like gets mad, in quotations, or is acting kind of silly with another character, because she raises the pitch of her voice even higher to get that stuff out, and it's just not great. So honestly, the reason why I don't want to stay with English isn't because of all of the characters in general. It's literally Paimon. It's literally her fault as to why I can't stand the English version of the game. Which is honestly pretty much what it was like back in the day when I used to play in Japanese and Chinese and would get through certain story elements. I would watch cutscenes on YouTube of those stories in the other languages just to see what they look like. I don't do this anymore, but this is what I used to do, like up to the Leeway event, or excuse me, up to like the Leeway fight against the big sea creature. And it was always Paimon that was the reason why I couldn't stand it. Even now I realize she was better back then. She was way better than she is now. If I had to choose to stay with English forever but could change one thing, give me back the old Paimon voice. I mean, it's a little bit less grating than it is now. It's a lot less grating than it is now. So I totally understand, and hopefully we'll probably be changing it sometime soon. I just don't know how soon. I might finish the Sumeru quest storyline in English first, and then we'll switch to a different language. But okay, question number two is, if you had to choose the single best thing about Genshin, what would it be? So I kind of already talked about this before. My favorite aspect of Genshin is its world exploration. The huge open world, the fantasy elements of, and bringing back that childhood love of being able to explore an open world like that with a gorgeous art style. And of course, I love the characters. Having all of these playable characters to mess around with, each with unique design and unique abilities. But if I had to pick one, it's the world exploration. Number three, things you hate or dislike about Genshin. Artifact grinding. I hate artifact grinding. So dislike, we'll say, is like kind of a general, like, eh, it's, you know, I don't really like it, but it's something I can deal with. I mean, I can deal with artifact grinding. It's just I actually hate the way the artifact grinding works. I dislike the weapon banner. I dislike how expensive the game is. When you are paying money to buy fates, it's way too expensive. I mean, you are paying like a lot of money for just a couple pulls, basically. But the only time I think that it's acceptable is the bonus that you get, the first time top up bonus. That's the only time I think it's acceptable to spend the money that they're asking for. But thinking about some other things, I dislike the event system. The amount of events. I hate events in general in games, but that's not just a Genshin problem. That's just in general. I don't like exclusivity. I dislike exclusive content for different users. So people that play on PlayStation have access to exclusive content, and I'm sure that PC players have exclusive content access. Battle Pass has exclusive content. If you don't buy it, you miss out on that content. And again, I'm happy that at least none of it is like characters. Right, except maybe Alloy as being the only character that you could have properly missed. But I'm happy that they don't have like, oh, if you play on PlayStation, then again, PlayStation got Alloy's bow. So either way, I guess it is still pretty shit. But whatever. Anyways, so number four on the questions list is favorite specific area so far. So example, Dragon Spine, Enkonomiya, Desert, Chasm, etc. So now this person's actually including the sub-regions. Now I did say Inazuma as far as visuals were concerned, but man, if we're talking specific area, it has to be the desert. It really does. I've talked so much about how much I love snowy regions in games, volcanic regions, and desert regions. And for the longest time, I've been saying I want Genshin to have a desert and a volcano, or volcanic region at least, right? I didn't really say too much about the snowy stuff because we had Dragonspine, but I want to reiterate that Dragonspine is not my idea of a snowy region. When I say snowy region, I'm talking like a landscape covered in ice and snow and stuff, right? You know, snow and icy rivers and stuff, not just a little patch of land with a mountain on it. So hopefully we get that, and I'm assuming we'll get that with Snezhnaya someday. That'll be a snowy and icy region. And I've been told that the Pyro region, which makes total sense, will be a volcanic region, or will revolve around a volcano at least, or something like that. Man, I cannot fucking wait. It's gonna be gorgeous. I have so many high expectations for that. And of course, we just got part of the desert added, and there's more desert coming. So that's also gonna be fucking awesome to mess around with. So specific area, desert. I love deserts in games, and Genshin is doing a great job at showing that you can make a desert look pretty. A desert doesn't have to just be a bland thing. I mean, if you look at pictures of real deserts, you can find really hot and vibrant sand colors and plant life and creatures that live in these places, these arid locations that are, yes, very harsh, but these places are not just bland and dead like every movie or game wants to show you. They can be vibrant locations in their own way. And Genshin has done a great job of showing that with like Mesa-y canyon areas, big open sand dunes, massive structures like the pyramids, and it looks gorgeous. And of course, the way that the sand reacts when you walk through it is awesome too. So question number 5 is, do you see yourself playing Genshin in the long run, like 5 to 10 years from now, until the story ends and all regions are unlocked? Yeah, absolutely. I don't see myself stopping for any other reason, unless of like it's a real life reason, like if I go to school. Then I probably wouldn't stop playing Genshin. I would probably just slow down on playing Genshin. But I don't think I would stop playing Genshin just because the story ends and all the regions are unlocked. Again, as we explained earlier, there might even be more content that comes out after that, where they continue the story in one way or another. I don't know. I mean, this is pretty popular of a game. So we'll have to see where it goes. But if they release all the regions and the story ends, but they have a lot of really interesting repeatable content, or like maybe a new game plus or something like that, then there would be plenty of reason for me to keep playing it even beyond the game's ending, so to speak. I would love a new game plus mode. That's a feature I would love to see. Of course, we don't really need that now because the game's not finished, but can you imagine waiting years, playing this game, dedicating a lot of time to it, getting to the very end, and then being able to open up a new game plus and start the adventure over, just carrying over a lot of your gear, resources, and characters, and being able to start at the beginning of the Mondstadt story again? Can you imagine that? That would be like mind-blowing, right? I would really love a feature that lets you respawn the chests without needing to create a new account. You know, being able to re-explore the open world and collect all those chests again. And plus, that would give you a reason if you were to, say, if they were to shut the game down, but to make all the characters available with primogems still, you would be able to refresh the world and re-explore it to get primogems and grind primogems by exploring or doing events that are permanently available or whatever, right? And then you could grind out characters that way as a way to prolong the game indefinitely. But anyways, continuing on. Number 6 is the favorite game you've ever played. It doesn't have to be from your Let's Plays. Favorite game I've ever played? Well, Steam will tell you on my Steam profile that it's War Thunder, because I have War Thunder listed as my favorite game. But that's literally only because of my playtime. I just showcase it because it's the game I've played the most. And yes, once upon a time, War Thunder could easily be considered my favorite game, with currently 8.4 thousand hours in it. But I don't think I would pick War Thunder as my favorite game now. I think the concept of War Thunder would be my favorite game. But it's not my favorite game right now due to some of its issues with the with how it's handled. So if I'm looking at my Steam, and I'm looking through my favorites, I have 44 games in my favorites. It's difficult to pick just a single favorite game because a lot of these games mean something to me. Like Final Fantasy X is a huge game to me. Like that's one of my favorite games of all freaking time. But it's also... it's also competing with like Borderlands 2, which we talked about recently. It's another one of my favorite games of all time. I think it's a great example of what I consider to be a perfect sequel. And that's another game that I could easily consider as being a favorite of mine. Let me see. Fallout 4, maybe not my favorite game, thinking of it, but it's another one of my favorite games of all time that I've played a lot of. I'm trying to just look at my list here just to make... The Witcher 3 used to be my favorite RPG of all time. Like, Subnautica is such a special game, too. It's really hard to pick a favorite game. Probably Genshin. maybe not entirely Genshin, but considering how much Genshin has done for me so far, it's a game that will... I mean, it's already a nostalgic game to me. I already feel nostalgia when I think back on locations we've explored or think back on things we've experienced or seen in the game. Which means, and it's only, I've only played the game for a little over a year, you know, or a year and a half. Which means that's how much of an impact this game has had. That's how much Genshin Impact has had on me, right? So it wouldn't be too far-fetched to say that Genshin Impact is my favorite game right now. You know, and that might change over time, who knows. But this is still a good question, but I think I'll pick Genshin Impact just because of how much it's done for me in just the past year and a half, and how little I have had issues with it. I mean, I've had issues with Genshin, but there have been so few, you know, and most of the issues I've had were just like annoyances or little gripes, nothing that's been seriously breaking my experience outside of maybe that Dragon's Spine challenge, but we don't need to talk about that anymore, because that's done and over with. But compare that to some of my other favorite games on my list where, yeah, like Borderlands 2, I love that game to death, but there are a lot of issues I have with it still. A lot of balance issues and stuff, so there's so many problems that I have with... Okay, sorry, my brain, like, shut off for a minute. There's so many problems I have with that game that I don't just have with Genshin Impact. But moving on to your next question, which is question number 7, your favorite anime. Oh boy, my favorite anime. Well, I base my anime favorites like based on seasons. So, and I don't mean like seasonal anime, I mean season 1, 2, 3 of an anime. And I do that because that's how they're sanctioned off on Analyst, which is where I keep track of all my stats of anime. So when I say like my favorite anime is season 2 of this show, I'm talking about season 2 of that show, but considering we're probably talking about the whole show as like overall, keep in mind that I have not seen every anime out there, and I also have not seen a lot of anime. I've tracked 213 anime on my analyst thus far, and some of those are like, you know, seasons of the same show, so keep that in mind. But it's pretty easy for me to pick Higurashi as being my favorite anime, just as a franchise. At least the core content. So Higurashi, Higurashi Kai, Higurashi Rei, Higurashi Go, and Higurashi Sotsu. And then, of course, you've got the spin-offs like Kaku, Kira, and the specials and stuff like that. So as a full package, as a full franchise, that would be the choice I would make. In fact, right now on my completed television anime, Higurashi Sotsu sits as my highest rated anime of all time at a 9.8 out of 10. And Higurashi Go, which is the season that precedes Sotsu, sits at 9.7 and is the second highest rated anime of all time for me. And then, of course, you've got Violet Evergarden, and then Higurashi Season 1, and then Higurashi Season 2. So in just the top 5 anime of all time, 4 of the 5 are Higurashi seasons, which says a lot for what I enjoy the most out of some of my anime. But some other honorable mentions I would say is I love ReZero, except Season 2, Part 2. I loved the Season 1, and I loved Season 2, the first part of Season 2. Fan-fucking-tastic show. I've rewatched it a few times now. I've watched it three times. Another good example would be Attack on Titan. That's a show, that's a journey right there. A show I thought I would hate and never watched for years until I was finally brought into it, and I was like, oh my god, this show's dope. It gets so good. I mean, it starts great in my opinion, but it just gets better and better and better and better. It never drops off, or at least for me, it never dropped off yet. And I've loved that show. It's pretty much gotten better every single step of the way. Season 1 was great, and then Season 2 was like, oh my fucking god, and then Season 3 Part 2 was like, you know, so that's my experience with Attack on Titan. Those are some different franchises I'd have to say, but there are tons of other shows I have hold in special regard. I hold Angel Beats very close. I hold Darling in the Franxx really close. I hold Anohana really close. All of those for different reasons. But just to recap on your question, my favorite would be Higurashi. And if I had to pick my favorite Higurashi season, it's a close call between Go and Sotsu as to be my favorite season, but the original seasons of Higurashi are very solid in the mystery that they formulate. So, okay, that's where I stand with that. Continuing on, number 8 is your favorite YouTuber, other than yourself, of course. Well, this one's easy. My favorite YouTuber is Nintendo Capri Sun, who you can find short-named as NCS or Timothy Bishop. I have watched this guy for probably some of the longest amount of time I've spent on YouTube has been spent watching this guy's Let's Plays. If you want to know anything about me, where I get a lot of my personality from and a lot of my outgoing jokes and some of my dark humor and some of my nasty like toilet humor and stuff, it comes from this guy. This is the reason why I make videos the way I do on YouTube, commentary specifically, why I commentate the way I do is because of Nintendo Capri Sun. He's hilarious, he's fun, he's enjoyable to watch, and he makes these like fucking hilarious montages, like death montages when he gets to a part of the game, like where he's getting his ass kicked, and just the things he says sometimes make me laugh. And I can watch the series 50 times and I will still bust a nut laughing at this guy. He is my biggest source of inspiration on YouTube and Let's Plays. Of course, I was watching other Let's Players like Scottish Duck 17 or Armageddon X. Those were some of my earliest Let's Players as well. But it was Nintendo Capri Sun that really formulated what I would come to be on YouTube. The Yogscast, early Yogscast specifically, was also a big part of my inspiration back in the day. But favorite YouTuber, NCS. I mean, I literally just said earlier, I have a tab open with his Let's Play Super Mario Sunshine Part 48, tons of blue coins in Penis Park. See, I mean, his humor is so, like, almost old school and almost childish, which is what I find so charming about it, right? And was why I find it so funny. It's immature humor that is, to a mature person like myself, really fucking hilarious. Anyways, that's where I stand with that question. I love this guy, and I would love for him to keep making content, which he does. I just haven't watched a lot of his new stuff. I've mainly watched his old stuff. I'm trying to get through all of his old stuff, and then every time I get through, like, 8 series from back in the day, from, like, 2010, if not earlier from him, I'll be like, okay, I'm going to start over and watch them all again. And I have never been able to get caught up yet. But I'm always watching this guy, so someday I'll get around to it. And then finally, final question is number 9, face reveal, wink, wink. This is for people that haven't been around on my channel for as long. I have actually revealed my face on the channel indirectly before. And I think some of those face videos are no longer public. They are still on the channel, they're just privated. Like a time when I was younger, I showed off my collection of mine that I had at the time, and I had my face in it because I was recording the through a video camera. But I ended up privating those because they were very... I'm very embarrassed about it because I was a kid, basically, you know, and I didn't want to be made fun of on the internet because, you know, people are nice on the internet usually, but no. But they are still out there. I just someday will probably make them public in like 50 years. But as for my actual face, I don't really have an interest in revealing it, nor do I have an interest in really keeping it hidden either. It's not really that important to me, but I'm probably not gonna like do a dedicated face reveal episode. You'll probably get like a face reveal kind of just from like maybe if I start doing vlogs about school or about moving or whatever, you probably end up noticing my face there, or if I like stream or something, and because I do have a webcam, if I decided to show my face through one of those, you would end up seeing it. But it's not, again, it's not something I'm purposefully keeping hidden, but it's also not something that I really feel a need to come out and just do, right? I mean, I lived through the era of face reveals and face cams on YouTube when that became a big thing, and I was never really big into it too much. Especially, sometimes I like to see the face cam in certain types of videos, but other times I think it can be a bit distracting with certain games, especially like it makes total sense to have your face shown in a game like a horror game, so that anytime you get scared, you get to see the person's facial reactions. But then at the same time, you always are blocking part of the screen with that, but then again, streaming is the same way. If you have a VTube model, like an avatar, or you have a face cam, you're always blocking some part of the game. And the stream chat, if you have that displayed on the screen, that's always blocking a part of the game, and it can be really distracting. So I don't know, it just depends, I guess, on how you handle it and how big you make it. I mean, I've seen some people that literally put their face in the corner of the game, and it's like a fourth the size of the screen, so you only have 3/4 of the screen to see the game, and it's like really just distracting. So, but whatever, someday I'm sure I'll show my face off in a dedicated way, just not in its own face reveal episode, unless I do. Who knows? Maybe. I don't know. I never want to say never. But okay, so that's it for Hachi's questions. So now I am going to look at... I guess this is the... Now I'm just double checking to make sure I haven't missed anybody. So I guess we have one person left with their series of questions. And this person is Kevin Lee, who posted 4 days ago. With 6 total questions. So question number 1 is, are you still going ahead with the Twitch stream idea you talked about a while back? Okay, well, we were just talking about streams. I guess we might as well continue. So as far as Twitch stream is concerned, back at like the start or end of last year or the start of this year, I talked about having the plans to do some sort of streaming. I was going to try Twitch or YouTube, probably try Twitch first. I don't know. It depends. But I was curious to give it a try, and that's actually partially why I got my whole new PC in the first place, was to be able to stream more regularly with a more readily available system that wasn't stuttering or freezing every 3 seconds when I was playing Genshin all the time. The thing is I had certain plans that I was going to do for the streaming, and those plans were actually going perfectly fine, and I have a camera, and I have my monitors and my PC, and everything's really kind of ready to go. I just need to figure out how to get Twitch really set up and figure out how it all works. But I was gonna start by streaming War Thunder content because it felt like a great way to start streaming, because it's a great game to stream, you know. I wasn't gonna start by streaming, like, you know, Let's Play content, because I'm still very much against that. But now I'm so dead end on War Thunder, and it's been even a worse experience in the past month, that I have so little desire to play War Thunder. You could pay me to play War Thunder and I would still be bleh about it, you know? Unless you were like paying me an anime ass. That's a different story. But it's really just a matter of getting it set up, getting the whole like stream stuff set up and figuring out how it works and doing some test streams and stuff before I can really kind of make it more of a regular thing. But as far as like what I would record or what I would stream specifically, because one of my biggest factors is I will not stream if I cannot back up all of my streams on YouTube. Like, all of my streams are absolutely being uploaded to YouTube. Everything I do is going to this channel, period. That's a rule. And I've been told that you can do that with streaming. You can back up the streams or have them recorded at the same time and then just upload them or transfer them over. So that's something that I need to do. But when, I don't know. I would like to at least give it a try before this year is over. But then again, we are halfway through October now, so time will tell. Anywho, question number 2 is, favorite region's OST overall in Genshin? For the record, mine is Dragonspine. Okay, this one is very interesting. This is a fun one because I talked about how powerful the soundtrack in Genshin Impact is, and I love it to death. And this is an interesting question because it's not just, you know, what's your favorite soundtrack in the game? It's just, what's your favorite region's tracks? Now, just like with the character designs and outfits and all that kind of stuff, where I want to do a full video breaking it down, I have also always wanted to do a video where I just talk about my favorite tracks in Genshin's OST. Of course, there's always new soundtracks coming out, and there's always new characters, but I would make a video up to wherever we are in the game's current version, and then beyond that point, I would update it down the road and do further versions of the video. But here's the thing about Genshin soundtrack. It is so good. I listen to it in passing. I mean, I listen to music all the time. If I'm not recording a video or I'm not watching another YouTube video or watching something in general, I am listening to music nonstop. And there is always Genshin soundtracks mixed in all the time. I'll go out of my way to listen to Genshin Impact music. I'll go out of my way to search specific tracks. And I will just listen to them and I'll daydream about them. And it's because they're that fucking good. They're cinematic is what these soundtracks are, in my opinion. They're so gorgeous. Better than most other games that I've played that have good soundtracks. They're better than those. And the thing that makes Genshin Impact so awesome is the fact that, of course, each region, it may be a fantasy world, you know, that we're playing in, not real life, but each region is based on a real-world culture, a real-world location. So, you know, Liyue being based heavily on Chinese culture, Inazuma being based heavily on Japanese culture, you know, that means that there is a level of familiarity to it, but it also means that each region you play through, you get to have this huge collection of distinct and amazing music with instruments from real-world locations and traditional styles and just so much. It's oozing with so much different, I don't know, it's just awesome that, because it means that there isn't just, oh, here's the Genshin Impact soundtrack, and then you listen to it and you're like, oh, okay, that's neat, and that's what you hear from the beginning to the end of the game. No, each region you explore through, it's like a whole new fucking game. Really, it is. It's so distinct from the last region you were playing in. You know, you can play around in Liyue, and you get to hear that battle music, and then you go over to Sumeru, whole different ballgame. You play in Inazuma, jump back to Mondstadt, whole different ballgame. It's like a totally different tone in how the music plays. So there is a lot to pick from. So it's, thankfully you did not ask the question, what is your favorite track in the game? Because that's impossible. But what is your favorite region? Well, I think every region is strong in its own way. There is not a single location that I dislike its music. I love the music in every place. And there's very few tracks that I like. There isn't even a track that I don't like in general, like where it starts playing and I'm like, oh, I hate this music. I don't want to hear this anymore. You know, that's never happened yet. Every track is either okay or fan-fucking-tastic. Now, I'll start off by saying that the chasm, right, the specifically the underground mines in the chasm, they have the best atmosphere. In just my opinion, but I think that the underground mines of the chasm has the best atmosphere in its soundtrack. It is creepy, it's unsettling. There's a level of intrigue there. There's a level of mystery in the way that the music is presented to you. Just that bass music that plays whenever you're just standing around, it's like really creepy. It's oozing atmosphere. And I love it so much. But that's not my favorite region's soundtrack. That's basically just one track that I like in a region, not a region of soundtrack that I like. I used to love, there are various tracks in Inazuma that I love. I love Inazuma City's theme. I love the Grand Narukami Shrine theme. I love a lot of the battle themes in Liyue, like, of course, Rapid as Wildfire, everyone's favorite. I love that. Pretty much every boss theme, and like every Trounce Domain boss, literally every boss theme is so fucking epic. It's ridiculous. I could listen to them over and over again. The Harbinger theme, which I only just recently learned this, but the Harbinger theme is what you hear throughout various of the Harbinger boss fights. You know, so like, for example, what I thought was basically Signora's theme, but then I ended up playing against Tartaglia in the Trounce Domain, and I heard the same motif played, and I was like, wait a minute, that's Signora's theme, right? But then I later learned, oh, it's actually the Harbinger theme, which is, I did not realize at first, which is so cool to hear it played again, but in completely different styles. Even Storm Terror's boss theme is so awesome. The fight against the giant wolf is so awesome. Sometimes they do weird things with the music too, like you get breakdance music in that fight, but it works. I don't know how, but it works. Of course, the Raiden Shogun's theme, whenever you were fighting her in the Archon story, fucking badass. And there's so many different styles of music, not even just culturally speaking, but like I said, you get that sort of breakdance sound. You get electric guitars and this heavy pounding, and you get choirs, and it's, wow, just I don't know how this music was written to be that diverse, and yet every single time I am blown away by what it sounds like. But anyways, the question is, what is your favorite region's OST? It's hard to pick. It really is. Well, it was hard to pick until I went to Sumeru and explored Port Ormos for the first time. Yeah, the Port Ormos theme is probably amongst my favorite just day tracks in the game. If you count every single city in the game, and then every single village that has a unique theme, Port Ormos is probably one of, if not my entire, just my favorite overall. But Sumeru City itself also has some gorgeous tracks in it, right? But so does Inazuma City. But I think Sumeru City it's such a beautiful region. Now, I'm still not fully sure what culture Sumeru is based off. I'm assuming Middle East, like maybe India in and around that area. That's just my guess. But I don't know anything really at all about that culture, so I don't know anything about the instrumentation that's being used. But boy, does it sound fucking awesome, right? That's all I care about. It sounds fucking awesome. But it is hard for me to say, is Sumeru my favorite overall as far as soundtrack is concerned? Maybe not. But it certainly has some of the best just day tracks I've heard so far. Very fun question, but very difficult question, because I love the atmosphere in the chasm. I love the battle. Every boss theme is awesome. I love the battle themes in Liyue. I love the day themes in like city and villages in Sumeru. I love the sort of almost depressing sound that the Inazuma soundtrack has. And of course, Mondstadt is just Mondstadt. It's where we started. Of course, I'm going to remember every track there really, really well. Anyways, moving on to question number 3, which is reiterating a point others have made, will you look at watching or reacting character demos? 3A, kind of related, but there are two lore pertinent limited story events you have missed in the history of the game, one from version 1.1 and one from version 1.2, the version you started playing. You did miss a story event from 2.2, but it was kind of a filler event. Are you down to look up their story cutscenes on YouTube? Well, first of all, obviously we already answered the whole reacting and watching character demo things. Yes, I just need a playlist. But for 3A, let's see. So they're talking about version 1.1 was before I started playing, so there was an event there I missed. And of course, when I started playing, I was so overwhelmed with all the systems in the game, I obviously would have missed out on limited time content. There has been other events I've missed, but I guess we're talking specifically about story events, like how they say story from 2.2. But are you down to watch story cutscenes on YouTube? On one hand, I would just jump and say no. I'm not really down to watching that. I would prefer that they actually make them available again in some form, and that I can play it and react to it myself on video as part of the main series. But then again, on the other hand, it's if that's not what they're ever going to do, which would suck, and I will forever hate HoYoverse for that if they decide to make that decision, then that would be my only option to see what I have missed, is to watch someone else have played it or watch the cutscenes on YouTube or something, right? So never say never, but I would prefer to be able to play them myself. Personally, which I'm sure makes sense to most people. Of course, you'd want to play it yourself, probably, but... Question number 4 is new PC versus old PC specs. All right, now there's an interesting one. Now, I'm assuming you're talking about specific specs and not just new PC versus old PC. Let me see if I can bring this up, because it's actually a little bit... Let me see. Let me go to see if I can find the specs of my older computer. So if I can open up this, which will show me the parts of my new PC. And then if I go to... Whoops. I need to find a really old chat on Discord. You see, my old PC, the one I was using before my current new one, the one that I had started Genshin on, it was like a hand-me-down PC, basically. I had a whole bunch of PC issues, and it kept breaking, and so basically I didn't have a lot of money at the time, and I pieced together what I could, was able to get a graphics card with my family. That was all we could pretty much supply. I believe the power supply was supplied by a friend at the time, who's no longer considered anything such like that. And then I believe the motherboard and CPU was... The motherboard, CPU, and RAM were provided to me by the person I'm looking for on Discord. They were basically hand-me-down parts from their crypto mining operation that they had, which meant that I had heavily used parts that were given to me. And then the hard drive, they also gave me an SSD that was already installed on the motherboard. And then I believe the hard drive I supplied myself, because it was only $50, and I was able to get that out of donations that were made. So I guess technically I didn't supply it. It was actually donations that were given by my channel viewers at the time, because I had made a video saying I need help because my PC's shit. It's fucked up. I don't have a PC, and I don't have money to get anything. Of course, I'm having trouble finding... I don't even remember what the person's name was. No, it looks like they're not even on my Discord anymore. So unfortunately, I don't think, unless I was like really, I'd have to go and find the old pieces, which are actually out in the living room in their boxes. They're not there, because I didn't get boxes with the product when it was sent to me, like the hand-me-down parts. They were put in the new boxes of my new parts after the PC was put together. But... just double checking to make sure none of these people are the same person, just changed their name. No, it doesn't look like it. Damn. It's freaking weird. Okay, then I will do my best to try to remember kind of what I had. So the parts that I did have, going from, we'll just start with the graphics card, because that's the most simple thing that was updated. So I was using an EVGA GTX 1070 Ti. That was the card that we had, my family and I had kind of tried to get together, because it was very expensive at the time, because it was overinflated, as parts always fucking are. And I had originally gotten the 1070 Ti for Far Cry 5's release, so it was in 2018. And it was a huge upgrade from what I was using, a 970, which is what I had beforehand. And I never really had an issue with my GPU at the time. It played every single game fine, and I don't think I ever ran into any issues. Although there were plenty of games that would have some pretty big performance problems, but I was never able to tell if it was my GPU, because I was never able to max out my GPU's memory, my VRAM. I was always certain that it was my CPU that was having an issue, because my CPU was always the thing that would be bottlenecking constantly. Even something as simple as opening a folder would shoot my CPU power up to 100%. So, speaking of, I have now jumped from the GTX 1070 up to my EVGA RTX 3070 Ti, which has been an incredible step up. I have never seen so much performance in my life with a game. I've never hit a single game that has given me any problems, except like early access games that have their own performance problems kind of baked in. I have been able to see thousands and millions of particles on the screen with no issue whatsoever. And of course, I also have the ability to use the special RTX features, which I have actually never done. I've never seen ray tracing, even though I have access to that. I've never actually tried it yet, so... mainly because that was never too interesting to me, but I don't know, I guess I have access to it. The graphics card upgrade was a huge portion of the cost of this PC. This GPU cost $1,000 because it's inflation season, and always is, even though the graphics card's only worth about $200 or $300. Now that $1,000 was used from basically the last of my Walmart savings. That was supposed to be going to school savings, and I put it all towards my PC as a last-ditch effort to try to get me back on my feet, basically, to get me back into making videos, because I wasn't doing anything at the time. Not too much at the time, rather. So that's the most expensive part of my PC. Now, this PC was put together by a friend. It was because I don't have a lot of knowledge on how to build PCs, so it was kind of pieced together by a friend who was like, hey, here's these parts that are really powerful but also cheap, so they're affordable. Not the graphics card. I said, this is the graphics card I'm getting. Can you build a PC around that graphics card? And that's what he did. And it's worked out amazingly well so far. So the motherboard, what I did have on my other PC was a, I don't remember what it was, but it was a gigabyte micro board. It was a very small board. And it was, I don't freaking know anything really about it, but it had an SSD loaded onto it, which was 120 gigabytes, the SSD was, and it had RAM of 16 gigabytes, and it was supposed to be gaming RAM, but it was really bad RAM. Again, probably because these parts that were supplied to me, while I was very grateful to have been given these supplies for free by just somebody who had them on hand, these parts were heavily used in mining, and the CPU was basically dead when I got it. And it was kind of chugging along from the moment that I got it up until the moment that I got my new PC. But I have gone from that board to an MSI B550M Pro VDH Wi-Fi Micro ATX AM4 board. Whatever the fuck any of that shit means, I don't know. I don't use the Wi-Fi, it just has Wi-Fi access to it. But this board has been working out very well. I went from 16 gigabytes of RAM up to... hold on a minute. What is that sound I'm hearing? Anyways, I went from, I went from 16 gigabytes of RAM up to 32 gigabytes of RAM, I believe, and it was switched over to G-Skill Ripjaws 5 32 gigabyte RAM across two separate sticks. So that's also been a huge improvement because my RAM would make it difficult to do specifically modded stuff where, you know, there's a lot of extra memory requirements. Minecraft is surprisingly ridiculous in how much RAM that shit requires just to get running somewhat partially. But this has made anything regarding those types of games and those types of game engines to work very well when pumping a whole bunch of mods into things. Now, the SSD went from that 120 gigabyte SSD, which, by the way, was really slow. What I was told, a solid state drive was supposed to be really fast. I had a lot of problems loading into stuff or getting stuff to run very well on that SSD, and plus 120 gigabytes is not a lot. I could have like one game. Genshin was pretty much all I could have loaded on it at a single time. And I would see the difference between running certain games, like Killing Floor 2 would always take like freaking 5 to 10 minutes to load up if it was on my hard drive, but on the SSD it would take about 4 to 5 minutes to load up. So it was faster, it just wasn't amazingly faster. And my Windows would still launch very quickly. My Windows was not loaded on the SSD, mind you, it was actually loaded on my hard drive, but it would load up a lot faster, which was here's the thing. The SSD I use now is a Samsung 970 Evo Plus 1TB, which is M2-2280. And the 1TB is incredible because I'm able to load all of my games at any one given time on this one SSD, and also Windows is loaded onto the SSD. Now, the thing that it worked before whenever I would turn on the PC on my old PC, see, nowadays, it's incredible how fast it loads up. When I press the power button on my computer, you know, after it's been shut down, it will flash, and then bam. I'm already up on the lock screen, open it up, and everything's already running. I only have, I think, Discord is all that I have that launches when the PC starts, and everything's already ready to go, and I'm able to start using the PC instantly. Like, I don't even get a chance to take my hand away from the tower before it's already booted the whole PC up. My old PC would boot really fast. It would turn on in about, within about 20 or so seconds, it would come up to the lock screen. The problem was it would take so long to get actually anything loaded. So back then I would have Steam and Discord at least that I would have launch at the start of the PC startup. So just about two things on average I would have loading up. But it would take literally like 5 to 15 minutes, somewhere in between there, before it would finally load everything in properly. And so what I would do was oftentimes I would turn the PC on and then go and lay back down in bed and then like lay there for a little while and rest for a little bit longer while the PC was getting ready. Because if I tried touching anything on the computer while that stuff was loading up, it would run slow for the rest of the time that I had the PC on until I shut it down again. It was really annoying to have to deal with that. So again, another huge step up was the SSD so far. Now the CPU went from, I don't remember the exact model, I used to if I had access to that Discord chat, but it used to be an Intel i5 something or other. And like I said, it had like a basic cooler on it. It had basically like the cooler that comes in the box with it. It had a huge bottlenecking issue where it would hit 100% for opening folders. I mean, there were times where I would open the folder on my PC. Pretty much every time I would open a folder on my PC, the entire computer would freeze for a few seconds and then would unfreeze and I'd be able to continue. Anytime I opened a new folder, that's what my computer would do. And so now I have changed to AMD with the Ryzen 7 5800X, 3.8 gigahertz is what I use now. Now, AMD, I used to, on my PC before the last PC, which was the one that had died, then required me to get the hand-me-down parts, I actually was using an AMD processor, and compared to the Intel i5, it was still better than the i5 I got. It was still more powerful and still felt a lot more smooth. It's just the whole fucking PC had died, and I had lost my CPU along with it. But as far as going from that i5 to this, I have never found a bottlenecking issue yet, and I've never felt the CPU dragging on. I've also never had a heat issue with this computer yet. I've never overheated. Even in the dead of summer when my air conditioner wasn't working correctly, I was still not overheating my PC. And the cooler, unfortunately, I don't have the cooler listed here, but the cooler that was given to me, or was suggested to me, or wait, do I have it on here? Let me see. No, I don't have it listed on here. But it's like this huge freaking block. It's just a fan with a huge heat sink cooler. And man, it is so ridiculously good at cooling that thing. Now it looks like it weighs about, and it does, it weighs like 40 pounds. Okay, it's not that heavy, but it does weigh a lot. And it seems to kick ass on keeping that thing cool, which is surprising considering I thought that AMD Ryzen's run pretty hot, but apparently not with that thing at work. So that was another huge step up, the cooling and the fact I haven't had a single overheating issue. The power supply has gone, I did upgrade the power supply. I think I was using a Corsair 750 watt, now I'm using a Corsair 850 watt gold, which is fine. I mean, I trust Corsair probably more than just about any other brand when it comes to their power supplies. I'm trying to think of the hard drive. I did have access to a lot of different drives in the past. Now I'm using only a single hard drive, and that's only because I didn't have enough money left. I had spent it pretty much all. I was literally getting up to the end of my budget here when I was trying to get this PC put together. But I have just right now a single 4 terabyte hard drive in my PC. It's a Seagate drive, I believe. And I have room to put other drives as well, so if I ever wanted to add more hard drives, I can do that. But let me see here. I guess the only other thing that's been upgraded with the PC is the case, which I was using some nameless case before, and now I'm using an Asus case. It's my first one that has a glass panel on it. Again, I literally do not care about seeing the inside of my computer. It's just, I needed this case because I needed a big case. And you know why I needed a big case? No, I've got a micro board because, you know, why would you need a big case? The fucking graphics card, dude. The 3070 Ti is the biggest card I have ever seen in my life. The 1070 Ti I was using, which I thought was huge, this thing's like 4 times the size of that and 8 times the weight. It's so huge. What the hell? I guess that's what happens with technology, but I thought technology made things smaller. Either way, that's pretty much my PC specs, old versus new. And overall, I have had an incredible experience with my new PC in comparison to my old PC. In fact, every PC I've ever owned has never been as good as this. And I've never had an issue with this PC yet. Oh, outside of course, the recording issues where I have the stutters and stuff like that on screen, which might be a GPU problem, I don't know. But I've never had like an actual issue with just using the computer or playing games on my own. I've never had issues there. It's never crashed. It has crashed, yes, when using certain softwares that again might be a GPU issue, but it's never just crashed just willy-nilly while I was doing my own thing. It's never frozen. It's never overheated or any of those kind of issues. So that's great. Anyways, continuing on with their questions. So question number 5 is favorite anime episodes of all time. Now, I'm going to be totally honest. I don't know how accurately I can answer that because while there are moments in anime that I really, really loved in some of my favorite shows, I don't necessarily remember the exact episode it happened in. You know what I mean? But that is an interesting question. So I guess since I can't really answer it as well as you probably were hoping with asking that question, the best I can do is probably substitute it with some of my favorite moments in anime. But at the same time, this might contain spoilers, so spoilers to certain shows here, spoilers to Attack on Titan. There are some awesome moments I have with Attack on Titan. In fact, I even have written down on my whiteboard over here some various moments from different shows. I really loved, of course, in Attack on Titan Season 2, the reveal of who the Armored and Colossal Titan were. That was one of my favorite moments. And that was, the moment where I was like, holy shit, this might be the greatest show I've seen all year, you know, at the time. Another Attack on Titan moment is Season 3, Part 2, which is Erwin's suicide charge. That was an amazing episode. Very, very, very epic. And then we have spoilers for Angel Beats. In the beginning of Angel Beats, there is the concert scene where Tenshi, as she's known at the point, is approaching while they're trying to get, whatever. It's Angel Beats stuff. That whole scene where they're trying to hold off Kanade from getting into the concert and stopping it was a very epic moment to me. Because just as for context, Angel Beats was my very first anime. So holds a special place for me there, and that scene is always awesome for me to rewatch every time I watch that show. Other stuff like El Noah Zero, a show I wasn't really too big a fan of, but the ship landing scene where it basically nukes a city is so fucking epic. The music, of course, it's Sawano, Hiroyuki Sawano, of course, the same guy that does Attack on Titan soundtrack. Of course it's going to be badass. But just the way that you see everything get blasted and the explosion pulls back from the oxygen being sucked out of the air and then it gets blasted out again. It's just so amazing the way that shot. And you could probably look at my analyst and say, pick any of these anime and then say, oh, what's your favorite moments from this show? And I could probably sit here and tell you my favorite moments from those shows. But those are some of the ones I've written down. And I started writing them down because I wanted to make a video someday where I actually cover my favorite moments in the anime I've watched. Of course, there are, just looking through the list here, I mean, there's a lot of anime that I love lots of moments about. It's I've never really thought about the episode number itself, which is why I'm not able to properly answer the question. I mean, ReZero, there's 20 different times that I fucking loved the moments that were happening on screen. The moment where later in the first season when Subaru is carrying the basically twisted and beaten and dead Rem, and sees Ram, and it's really disgusting, and he's walking up on the snow-filled mansion, and it's just such a depressing scene, and I loved every single fucking minute of it. The soundtrack that plays there is gorgeous as well. There's plenty of moments in shows like Darling in the Franxx that I really liked, A Girl's Last Tour that I really liked as well, that I could say were probably some of my favorite moments in anime too. And of course, fucking Higurashi. Where do we begin with my favorite moments in Higurashi? But yeah, that's hopefully the best that I can answer that, and hopefully it works. But anyways, number 6 on the question list is most nostalgic area in Genshin? Easy, Mondstadt. I think for most people, it's probably going to be Mondstadt because that's where you start the game. But from what I saw on the Discord server, it was actually different for some people. You know, someone said Dragonspine, another person said Liyue. For me, it was Mondstadt. Now, of course, the Great Chili Hunt was very nostalgic, going through Liyue for the first time very early on in our experience. So I remember seeing, you know, Liyue Harbor for the first time. That was very nostalgic to think back on. But it's the soundtracks that play, like usually the night tracks that play in Mondstadt. It's the terrain of Mondstadt, that like kind of jagged cliffs and just green fields, you know, that I remember most fondly. I love looking for shrines of the depths or whatever in this game, but it's the Mondstadt shrines that I remember the most, because that was like the most nostalgic. Go out and search, look for them, try to find them, because it was, you know, Inazuma, it's not hard to find the shrines because they're islands. So it's very easy to find the shrines that are tucked away in the corner. But I still remember the one shrine, I think it was the last shrine in Mondstadt that we didn't have yet, which was the one that was tucked up right, like sort of in between two cliffs on right next to Springvale. And I couldn't find it. It was the last one I was missing. And I remember finding it, and that was just such an uplifting feeling I had. So yeah, easy to answer that question. Mondstadt is my most nostalgic region in the game. And maybe that'll change over time, because each time I explore a region for the first time, memories are formed there, you know? I remember going to Inazuma for the first time. I remember exploring parts of Liyue for the first time. And I, of course, am going to remember Sumeru for my first... I already feel pretty kind of, you know, squidgely about going to the desert in Sumeru for the first time, because it was at a specific part in time where at the end of September and the beginning of October, where I was kind of not doing very well and I was playing Genshin to escape reality, and getting to see that and be so excited for the desert formulates these sort of sad and happy opinions, or excuse me, memories at the same time. And to finish off, they say, while we're on the topic of upcoming stuff, I took a sneak peek at your account, and it seems I'm in for a treat with a certain character you have crowned a talent for. So obviously by now people will know what they're talking about, but they're referring to Ganyu, who was my very first character to have a crowned talent in my entire playthrough, and was the character that I've been putting a lot of time and resources into try to make as powerful as possible. So, sneak peeking, you're not supposed to peek at your gifts under the tree, you're supposed to wait, be patient, but I didn't know you could see that kind of information. I know that you can, like, look at my profile and see the characters I have listed, but I guess I forgot you can actually open the character and look at their stats and stuff, and I guess what gear maybe they're carrying. But that's it, guys. I think I've covered every question that was posted in its entirety, and... This episode is now 3.5 hours long. So the first one is 2 hours and then 3.5, which means we're looking at about a 5.5 hour long video or a Q&A session that'll be split between two videos. Maybe three if I can't get this one to render out correctly, but if it renders out fine, then there will be at least two parts. But this was awesome. I love doing discussion videos. I love doing Q&As like this where I get to have people ask me stuff and then I just get to answer it. So thank you so much for participating in this, and it was a lot of fun, and hopefully we'll do something like this again in the future. And hopefully by now I have collected enough wood to be able to do something in the game with my housing. So I will see you guys in the next episode of Let's Play Genshin Impact.